Hello, listeners, and welcome once again to the Rad Rascals podcast. We are at episode number 20. Andy, it is another 10-episode milestone. Can you believe it? I am one of your hosts, Ben, and back with me for the 20th time, I still can't believe it, is Andy. How are you doing, sir?
I'm actually 19th episode for me, because I missed that one.
Oh, I forgot. Yes, that's when you had Caroline filled in, and I was accosted by the females on the episode.
Yeah, fuck yeah. I'm too rascally. Too rascally to be cool in 20 episodes, so I'm lagging. I'm at 19.
Yes, I'm the only one who's managed the full 20-episode stretch. It's like the podcast goatsy, you know. I've done pretty well. We both have done pretty well, actually, and I couldn't be happier that we're celebrating another 10th episode under our belts.
Yeah, I mean, when we started this, we were like, yeah, we'll just do one, see how it goes, and I don't think we'd ever really anticipated that we'd get to 10, let alone 20, so I think it's cool, man. It's good.
Exactly. Now, we haven't actually planned anything specific for this episode. I know for the 10th episode, we had that four-hour Q&A marathon, which was a lot of fun, and we will definitely plan that for some time in the future. But I think if we were to celebrate every 10-episode milestone, it wouldn't be as special. You know, we got to kind of stagger it a little bit. What do you think?
Yeah, I think we're special enough as it is, so.
Yeah, the short bus has just pulled up.
Yep.
Exactly. But we will do something commemorative at some point. Now, the other thing, too, is this week we don't actually have a guest. So it's Andy and I just flying solo. The person that we did have planned, they couldn't make it. That happens. That's the nature of podcasting. And, you know, real life has to come first, and we completely understand that. So hopefully the guest that we have planned, which we're not going to mention here because we want to keep it as a surprise, hopefully they'll be able to make it some other time. So for this week, it's just Andy and I. So there's really no buffer. We have to tolerate each other full force.
Yeah, we'll see if we can manage it this week.
Yeah, it's actually been a while since we've done just the two of us. It's interesting. We started off four episodes with just ourselves, and then we kind of started the ball rolling with the guests. It feels kind of weird to be going back kind of old school.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of looking forward to it. I love having guests on, but I know, it just mixes it up a little bit.
Exactly. It's a good old-fashioned Ben and Andy chin wag that we can have here.
But sausage fest.
A wiener fest, as it were. And I can't believe I'm starting to use words like chin wag. It started with snez. Now I'm starting to use British terms. People are just not going to understand what I'm saying now.
It's the way forward, mate. It's the future.
Exactly. Well, I am of English extraction, partly. So for me, it's kind of like going back to my roots in a way. My drunken English-Irish roots.
Good.
Exactly. But what we wanted to do, first of all, because this is episode 20 and we did want to make some mention of it, is to give a big thank you to everyone who has listened to us for all of these episodes, as well as the people who have joined us as we've gotten progressively more into it. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, Andy, but I think our listener base has been steadily growing over the past little while, and it's kind of hit an upswing lately.
Yeah, I mean, the first episode, we did get a lot of listeners. I think that's one of the most, I don't want to say well-received, but it had the most listener base in. And of course, just you do die down just to your regulars, but we have been amping it up recently. The last one, penis scratching post, got a fair few YouTube hits. I think we're around the 300 mark on that, which it's good, man. I mean, I think it could be due to the penis being in the title, but I don't know.
I'm willing to bet that, and I'm also willing to bet that the two dislike votes we got were from people who came there expecting something different based on the title, and they didn't get it. So if you're listening, we do apologize. There was only allusions made to penises being scratched. There was no actual visuals, and there were no penises to be found in that video. So nice. we're sorry we, shall we say, caused your hopes to rise and then go limp. That's just what we do. As rascals, that's exactly what we do. But we've also had some great guests on the show, and I think a big thank you to everyone who took time out of their Sunday to join us on the podcast, and also those who have expressed interest. I know that we can't get everyone on who wants to be on when they want to be on. That's just the nature of podcasting. But, you know, to everyone who did show interest, we hope to eventually get you on the show. We're not discriminating. Pretty much everyone and anyone is welcome. But, you know, Andy, we also have kind of our wish list of people that we want to get on, too. So we're trying to balance that with what the community wants as well.
Yeah, I mean, the listeners make the podcast, but we got to be selfish as well at times. We got to I mean, I want to get Jesus on at some time, so I've written him a letter. He hasn't replied to me yet, and Santa as well. I've asked Santa to come on. Haven't had any responses yet, but I'm hoping they will come on at some point.
Well, keep in mind, it took Jesus 3 days to respond, so, you know, it might take you a little while on that.
Yeah, and Santa only works one night each year, so
the rest of the year, he's surrounded by his ho-ho-hos.
Yep. What about the Easter Bunny? Do you reckon the Easter Bunny will come on?
I don't know. I've seen people have been sending around pictures where he got hit by a car and the eggs just spilled all over the highway. So I don't know if he's ever going to be on the show. I think he's dead.
Oh.
At least that's what my parents told me. They shattered my childhood when they told me the Easter Bunny wasn't real. So I've been a bitter little shit ever since.
Can't blame you. How old were you when they told you?
I believe I was 9 years old. And it was... Here's the thing. Christmas and Easter were always the night before is always when I actually made an effort to go to bed early, because I was told if you don't get to bed early enough, Santa and or the Easter Bunny, depending on the time of year, they won't show up. Mm. And we used to get massive Easter baskets. Well, my brother and I would have one to share, but there'd be like enough chocolate in there to keep us hopped up on sugar for months on end. I mean, they went all out, and then they hid it all over the house. So kind of the pleasure of it was finding chocolate eggs everywhere. And then my father, I think he was drunk at the time, probably, he just said, "There's no Easter Bunny. It's Mom and I who do it."
Ouch.
I haven't recovered. And it goes some length to explain certain things about me, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, my parents never told me that the Easter Bunny didn't exist. I didn't get anything at Easter. They told me that the Easter Bunny hated me. So that was all right. He existed, but he was an arsehole. I could live with that. And then as I kind of grew older, I realized that he didn't exist. But if I'd had the bubble, the illusion burst for me, I don't know how I'd take that.
Well, Santa was a little bit easier on me because I was 11 years old, actually 10 years old, sorry, and I happened upon a stash of receipts for all the gifts that were labeled Santa on Christmas morning, so I was able to kind of connect the dots, but that wasn't a purposeful thing they did.
Mm.
So, yep, I've recovered since, you know, in the 20-some-odd years since this trauma has occurred, but no, I mean... Back to the topic of guests. I mean, we've reached out to several people in the community. Almost everyone has shown interest. A couple haven't responded, which is perfectly fine. I mean, podcasting is not for everybody. I know some people are deep thinkers as opposed to quick thinkers, and they'd prefer just to kind of keep it on YouTube. And hey, we're perfectly fine with that. We're still a community. We're not bitter. Well, Andy's not. I can't say for myself. I have to email you people. But, you know. But to everyone who's shown interest, thank you. We will have you on eventually. And everyone who's been listening for all these 20 episodes, a big thank you from all of us. I know we say it pretty much every episode, but, you know, given the support that we've had, given the fact that we now have our own forum, and we're working on some pretty cool plans for the future, we can't say thank you enough because we owe it all to you. So thank you for joining us.
Yeah, I mean, thanks. I just want to echo that. I enjoy the shit out of doing these podcasts, and to have people just listening to it, it's icing on the cake. So cheers, geezers.
Cheers, geezers. And I should also point out, too, that I get up early Sundays, which for me is not an easy thing to do. And I would not be doing it for something I didn't enjoy, especially this Sunday, because we're currently, what is it, July the, what, 15th today?
Yeah.
My brother's birthday is on July 19th, and I was celebrating it last night. I came home at 4 in the morning, pissed out of my brain, figuring I was going to be hungover as fuck. And I woke up and just feeling, okay, I'm going to do a podcast. That normally never happens. I'd just be crawling out of bed being like, okay, I need Advil and 3 Diet Cokes. No, I'm here for, you know, the podcast, and I'm enjoying it. So, yes, this podcast gives me motivation to actually get my ass out of bed. So that must be doing something right.
Beautiful.
Exactly. But speaking of community and interaction and all that wonderful stuff, we did have a question of the week last mm-hmm. week, and people chimed in with some pretty interesting answers, I would say. The question was, what have been some of the standout games of 2012 so far, and what upcoming games in 2012 are you looking forward to? So we put this question out on the forums, on Twitter, and I believe Facebook. I don't remember. But nobody responds on Facebook. I think the community hits us up on the other sites, and Facebook just kind of runs dry. We'll still post it there, but regardless. Andy, why don't you lead us in with the first answer?
All right. So, annoying Navi. So far, the best game I've played this year is Kid Icarus Uprising. I'd go as far to say it's one of the best games ever made. People complain about the controls, but I think they're perfect. They just take practice. So that's a 3DS title, isn't it, Kid Icarus?
It is. It is, and the common complaint is that people who played it with the Circle Pad Pro, they can't go back to playing it with just the one circle pad. And people who are left-handed, I know Pete Dore and Holly, Dog in My Lens, are both left-handed. I'm left-handed as well. Apparently, they have a little bit more difficulty with it, but I haven't played it, so I don't know how I would adapt to it.
Yeah, I haven't played it yet, but I've seen it. I've seen the box, and I want to play it. Just when I have cash, I'll
Yeah.
play it.
Yeah, hey, after the wedding, man, it's back to the game collecting days.
Yeah, looking forward
Exactly.
to
I'm looking forward to it as well. Finally, Andy's going to get some non-PS2 titles. There we
it.
go. Nostalgia King Eric, he said, "As for this week's question, the real standout game for me was Mass Effect 3. It really did a fantastic job of pissing the fuck out of me." I'm sure that's not uncommon for people who played it. Uncharted Golden Abyss for the PlayStation Vita was fantastic for the most part. Just more awesomeness with Nathan Drake, sorry. The only games I'm really looking forward to this year in 2012 are Borderlands 2. He's got to finish the first one. New Super Mario Bros. 2. Assassin's Creed 3, possibly. Luigi's Mansion, Dark Moon, the Epic Mickey game, the one that's going to be coming out, and whatever else strikes my fancy on the Wii U. Also, Transformers War for Cybertron. Because well, because he oh sorry, Fall of Cybertron. He absolutely loved War for Cybertron. So he's got some good games to look forward to, that's for sure.
Man, those two titles are so close. What's that? Fall of Cybertron and War for Cybertron.
I hate it when they do that because I constantly get them mixed up, and I'm picturing parents going into the store not knowing which game to get because all
Yeah.
they're going to remember is Cybertron, so Fall or War. I mean, at least with Transformers, they did Dark of the Moon, which always makes me think of Pink Floyd, but that's totally a side story.
The next answer is from R.E. Lewis, R.Lewis 2011. While I haven't had a chance to play any games that have been released this year, he's been primarily focusing on the tremendous backlog of games. There are quite a few that he's been looking forward to. Fear to Rhythm Final Fantasy being one, which should be arriving in the mail early next week. Man, that's a good game. I hope you enjoy it. And he's really looking forward to Kingdom Hearts: A Dream Drop Distance. Being the fanboy that he is, I can't read that bit because it's cut off for me. He pre-ordered, sorry, Mark of Mastery Edition along with the strategy guide. Also, really looking forward to Hitman Absolution, Pokemon White and Black 2, Resident Evil 6, Luigi's Mansion 2, and Tekken Tag Tournament.
Now, don't think I didn't notice that you giggled a little bit when he said Hitman Absolution.
Yeah. For that, what's the for some reason I read that as Hilton Absolution, and
Hilton.
I had fucking imagery of Paris Hilton for some reason with a fucking chihuahua. I don't know. I've been drinking, man. I can't help myself.
Oh God, Hilton Absolution. It's like the sequel to her sex video. Now with 1080p night vision.
Love it.
Focusing on that fellatio. There we go. Darrow, Mr. United Gamedom, his favorite game of the year thus far is Journey.
Hooray!
That's a game I still have yet to play, and I hope to rectify that very soon. Just a beautiful game that touched me in so many ways.
Ooh,
Giggity. And the ending almost brought me to tears and how powerful it was in my eyes. So he something touched him, and then something powerful shot into his eyes. There we go. Others include Theater Rhythm, Final Fantasy, Diablo 3, Syndicate, which is apparently an excellent cyberpunk first-person shooter, Azura's Wrath, Final Fantasy 13 2. Games that he's looking forward to are Darksiders 2, Tales of Graces F, which is coming out in the UK in August, Borderlands 2, Paper Mario Sticker Star, Professor Layton and the Miracle Mask, Project P100, Rayman Legends, Assassin's Creed 3, etc., etc., etc. Darrow is Mr. Games, so he's always got like a mountain of games to play. So this year should serve him pretty well.
Yeah, I actually don't think Darrow eats anything, because he just buys games, and then when he plays them, he grinds them up into dust and snorts them for nutrition.
He eats games and shits pixels.
Yeah.
There we go.
The next one is Pegasus 187. Standout games this year are Ultimate Fighting Championship Undisputed 3, which is a really great fighting game, Jak and Daxter Collection, Shoot Many Robots, an awesome Xbox Live Arcade title. Screw IGN and their trolling 4.5 rating. I actually tried the demo of that. And while it is repetitive, it does seem like a lot of fun. And, I mean, fuck IGN. No one likes those bastards.
It's like Borderlands meets Metal Slug. That's the impression I got from it.
Yeah, it seems really good. I'm going to pick it up when it comes down on price, like on a sale or anything.
Mm-hmm.
It does look good. Looking forward to Tony Hawk's Pro Skater HD, which is part of the Summer of Arcade, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Black Ops 2, WWE 13, Assassin's Creed 3, the white PS Vita bundle with Assassin's Creed 3 Liberation, and the Wii U with New Super Mario Bros. 2.
Ooh, somebody's going to be getting some new systems this year.
Yeah, looks good, man.
I'm envious. Sort of. Crazy Craft. He said the games that are standouts for him thus far are Tales of Graces F, The Witcher 2, Mass Effect 3, The Darkness 2. Glad to hear some love for that game. Lollipop Chainsaw. The upcoming games that he's looking forward to are Persona 4, The Golden, Borderlands 2, Assassin's Creed 3, and Dishonored. So looks like a lot of people looking forward to Borderlands 2 and Assassin's Creed 3. So if you follow any of us on Twitter, that's all you're going to hear this fall. I'm giving you advance warning right now.
Yeah, I was just thinking about it today, and I think Borderlands 2, I will buy it. I think I'll buy it day one.
Yeah.
I want to get that cool limited edition with the loot box.
That one I heard is long since sold out.
I'll find a way. I'll prostitute myself or anything. I want that box. I'll put my cat in it.
Okay, you are going to have to give a lot of blowjobs to get that, because that edition, and this has been pissing fans off, because it's called the Ultimate Loot Chest Edition, and it's sweet. Actually, one of the developers at Gearbox, people were questioning how big the actual box is, so he posted a picture on Twitter with his dog in it to show actually how big it is. I want that, because that is a great limited edition, but in pre-orders, it's sold out in record time, and people are now selling their pre-orders on eBay for ridiculous sums of money.
I'll find a way, man. I'll suck money a cock. I'll get it, man. Don't worry.
Dude, you do that for free. What's
Yeah, I'll change it up. I'll mix it up. So there we what's go. Free. If you want to continue subscribing to Andy's cock sucking services, you gotta give me a loot box.
This is inflation for you.
Yep. Fellation inflation.
Okay, that's gotta be our new episode title, Fellation Inflation. Mark that one up, Andy.
I'm writing it right now.
There we go.
Right, okay, so thank you to Zarvin1718, 1718, actually corrected me on the forums, I believe it was. In the last response... Start again, sorry. In my last response to your question, I said I'm cheap. Well, I'm saying the same here. I haven't bought a game that came out this year yet. I like to wait 6 months at least most of the time, and games will drop in price by a lot. Plus, there are still tons of games this generation and previous generations that he hasn't played yet and could be bought for really cheap. The only games I've almost bought were Xenoblade Chronicles and when I get a 3DS, Kid Icarus. I'm looking forward to some Wii U launch titles if I get one at launch. So, dude, get Xenoblade Chronicles. I mean, if you could pick it up for cheap, it's 100 hours right then. It's a beautiful game. So do it. Do it now.
Definitely good value for money. Midipore, he says, games that have stood out so far, Journey, Diablo 3, Phantasy Star Online 2, which has that even come out yet?
Yeah, in Japan. So he's been reading kanji or katakana okay. Or whatever the fuck.
Okay, yeah, that's not going to be ported to the West until 2013, I believe.
Mm.
So, games he's looking forward to, budget permitting, are Heroes of Ruin, Guild Wars 2, Borderlands 2, and he put in brackets, me and Ben will both be staying up for this bad boy. Very right he is. Zombie U, Pikmin 3, and Dishonored. Dishonored's actually interesting. That looks like a very good... I know Bethesda has almost become profanity on this podcast, but I think it looks good.
Yeah, I mean, they're only publishing it. They're not developing it.
Okay, so that one gets a pass. Almost. Yeah.
I mean, I'm looking forward to that game. I'm not sure if I'll buy it, but I'm definitely going to rent it day one.
Oh, there you go.
The next one is from Ninja Penguin 8969. Best games for me this year so far have been The Walking Dead, Azura's Wrath, Binary Domain, because of French robots. Yes, win. That's, is it Kane? I can't remember the name of the French robot, but he's awesome.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, he's just fucking awesome. I love that guy. Resident Evil Revelations, upcoming games, Ask Creed 3, Halo 4, Resident Evil 6, Dark Souls 2, Epic Mickey 2, and Fall of Cybertron.
Yay. That's a good roster of games you got there, my friend. The White Penny, he actually is taking a little bit of a diversion here. He says, well, you guys seem to think that 2012 has been a good year for gaming. I myself see this year as absolute trash. After looking at the games released this year, I realized I've only played one game so far. Most have been retro. That game is Ease Origin on Steam. I myself got hooked on the game for the first time in years. Beat the whole thing in 3 days, which for a guy who works like I do is quite a feat. As for what I'm looking forward to, only three games. The Last Story, which he's pre-ordered, Counter-Strike Go, and da-dum, Borderlands 2.
Man, we're getting a lot of anticipation for Borderlands 2.
I think we're going to need to form like co-op cliques here and just grind it together. Actually, that'd be a good thing because we did, for a while at least, we kept it going, was the Rad Rascals Battlefield 3 nights. Maybe when Borderlands 2 comes out, have like a community night for Borderlands.
That's good, man. That's a good idea.
I think we'll definitely visit that because there's a lot of interest. I know a lot of people are going to be getting it. Obviously, the platform you get it on will kind of determine how good the co-op's going to be. Like, I'm going to be getting it on a 360. That's just generally where I prefer to play my online games. So we'll see what people get when it comes out and try to form something around that. So definitely something to look forward to in September.
Yeah. Yeah. The next one, Video Gamer 76. As for me, the two games that have stood out this year are Final Fantasy 13-2 and Tales of Graces F, which is his personal game of the year so far.
I've been hearing really good things about that game.
Yeah, I mean, the Tales games have always been good. And I mean, if you buy them, you know that they're going to retain their value. I don't think any Tales game has ever lost any form of value. So if you buy one, it's kind of like an investment nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's I love the Tales games. Like, I haven't played them as of late, but it's definitely a series that I hope to get back into someday. From Twitter, we got a response from Comeback Kid, former guest of ours. Lollipop Chainsaw is obviously his favorite game of the year. He's absolutely been raving about it. The games he is looking forward to are Halo 4, Resident Evil 6, and he's calling it his future game of the year, Borderlands 2.
Fingers crossed.
Mm-hmm. I just realized that with all this anticipation, if that game turns out to be a turd, it's going to be worse than the Mass Effect 3 ending debacle. I think it's going to be apocalyptic in the gaming community.
Yeah, I don't think Gearbox will do that. I mean, Borderlands came out of nowhere. It's a new IP and it blew everyone away. I mean, Gearbox did have kind of a, I don't want to call it a fuck up with Duke Nukem Forever, but it wasn't as great as a lot of people were hoping. But I think Borderlands 2, I hope they're going to hit the ball out of the park on this one.
I will be very sad if they don't.
Sad face.
You would not believe how sad my face is going to be. I may need to go into therapy after that. as if having it already would not be a good idea, but this may just push me over the edge. But let's be optimistic here. Borderlands 2, it's going to be a great game. Hopefully it will live up to expectations, but I think given all the hype and all the expectation, I don't think Gearbox, like you said, I don't think Gearbox is going to fuck it up too badly. But let's reserve judgment until September when it comes out, and then we'll just kind of see how things develop from there.
Yeah. It'll be cool. Don't worry, man. The next one is Carnivore 2099. He's after my heart. He well and truly is. He said, been loving the Walking Dead episodes myself. Don't think I'm playing anything else from this year. It's just Walking Dead all day, every day.
Yep, it's been a very short year of gaming, that's for sure. But I know Neil also is into like the retro and the Steam games. But yeah, The Walking Dead, I mean, we talked about it last week. I burned through those in one night, and I'm begging for more. Like, I just want episode 3.
Yeah, mid-August, apparently. So they say mid-August. I reckon it'll be like November.
Do you think after they get all, because there's 5 episodes in total that are planned, right?
Yeah.
Do you think they're just, after they get all 5 of them out, they're just going to release them all as one bundle?
More than likely, I mean, because they've already sold the season passes for the PS3 and PC. You could just buy them up front for a discounted price. But I wouldn't be surprised if they don't do like a budget retail disc version, like season 1, Walking Dead. They'd do that, I think. I mean, I think they did it for Sam and Max, because they've done multiple seasons of that, so...
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they did Jurassic Park and Back to the Future as well, which those two weren't too well received, and I don't think they'll really release those as bundles. I don't know, but I hope they do.
I'll probably still buy it, just to play through them again.
Mm.
Okay, and the next one here is from Saturn Sonic. He says, I haven't really had a favorite new one, LOL, but I am looking forward to Sonic and Sega All-Stars Transformed. Can't wait. So, actually, that's a game no one's mentioned yet. It's the follow-up to Sonic and Sega's All-Star Racing, which, is, if you haven't played it, is a fantastic racer on the 360 and the PS3. I think on Steam as well. I'm not 100% on that. But that is a fantastic, very drift-heavy racer, which I'm not even a huge Sonic Universe fan, but, you know, they have a lot of really good diverse characters, and it's just a lot of fun. If you can get some people online, and I think the community is still good, you can definitely have a great time with it. And the sequel's looking to be really good, too, based on what I've seen. So it's good to finally hear someone acknowledging that game.
And the last one is from Gigastorms, who is another one that liked The Darkness 2, Syndicate, Diablo 3, and The Walking Dead episodes.
Very nice. We're seeing some common threads here.
Yeah. So, I mean, I just hope Walking Dead episodes 3, 4, and 5, that they live up to 1 and 2.
Well, they're going to be a continuation of kind of your decisions made throughout the first episode. So, and I made quite a few bad choices. So I don't know how it's going to turn out for me, but I'm sure either way I'm going to like it.
Mm.
So they did bring out their A game with the first two episodes. And I think, yeah, I mean, graphically, the games aren't very good. But, I mean, just the intensity of the game, the choices you have to make, and the voice acting is fantastic.
Yeah, I just hope the story doesn't kind of fall flat on its face. But we'll see. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, mid-August, man. We'll see how the third episode pans out.
Fingers crossed. Or November, whenever they get around to finishing it.
Exactly. So that is the answers to our question of the week, and we will have another question at the end of this episode. But we did have a couple topics we did want to delve into here, and because we don't have a guest, we're just going to dive head first and see where it goes. But one of the main topics we wanted to cover, and it's a very big topic in the news lately, at least in the world of gaming, is Kickstarter. There's new campaigns starting up every week. There's very high profile ones that have raised a lot of money, just in fan donations and people backing it. But before we kind of go into the individual cases, what is Kickstarter? That's the question. Andy, why don't you give us a little overview of what Kickstarter actually is and what the purpose is?
Okay, so Kickstarter, it can be for anything. It can be for a business that you want to set up, if you want to make a video game, if you wanted to create clothes for cats, you could create a Kickstarter. And what you have to do is just go along, type in the information, and say, I need X amount of money. It could be $100, it could be $1 million. And you say, I need it to create a shop so I can create clothes for my cats, like top hats. And you can request pledges from members of the public. So you can put pledge amounts. So for $1, you could just say, I will thank you. I will send you an email thanking you for contributing to my project. At $15, you can say, I will send you a top hat for your cat. At $30, I will send you a top hat and a monocle, etc., etc. And basically, you're asking for pledges, and if you hit your target, be it $100 or $1 million, then your Kickstarter is considered I've lost my words.
it's considered successful. So
yeah.
the way it works is, and this is the interesting part of it, you're backing the project. So if you're going to donate and say, yes, I want that top hat for my cat. You know, you're a consumer. You're saying to yourself, yes, that is a great idea. I can't wait to see my cat in that hat. And I'm going into Dr. Seuss territory here, but no matter. What's going to happen is you pledge the money, and then that's basically you authorizing that you're going to donate that amount of money. And it's whatever amount you see fit. So the minimum is always $1. And then, you know, as Andy said, with incremental amounts, you get better benefits because you have to give people an incentive to want to donate money. So it could be, you know, say for, it even goes higher, you know, for $100, you get like, you know, a top hat and a monograph handkerchief. for $1,000, Andy will personally come over to your house and fillet you. I mean, these are all the different things, and everyone kind of offers something different. To give an example, our good friend Jason Heine of the All Gen Gamers podcast and the Emulator Review on YouTube, he started a Kickstarter to get his new album out. Mm. He's got a new album. Everything is finished. And he is always, I mean, he's looking to get the distribution for it. So he's looking to raise $3,000 over 30 days. And he's currently got about 11 backers. So if you don't hit your goal, you get the money. If you don't hit your goal, you don't. So there is a bit of risk that comes with that. So that's kind of in a nutshell how it works. Now, the other thing, too, is that there is a financial risk as well, because even if the project is successful, there's no guarantee that it's actually going to come to fruition. That's just money you're giving them to develop the project. It may not actually come to fruition. So if you're a game developer and you have a Kickstarter program, often what a lot of them are doing, the money's only going to get them to the point where they're going to be at beta. They may need other money from other developers or other investors. So, you know, you're donating money for something which doesn't exist. But at the same time, if you look at other projects, like Andy, you backed one of them, didn't you?
Yeah, I've backed a few of them, actually. But the one that I've always been raving about is Wasteland 2 from In Exile Games and Brian Fargo. And I mean, that's the thing you said. If you do pledge, and I pledged, how much was it? I pledged $150, I think. And I mean, they reached their goal of, I think they just wanted $900,000. I think they got near enough $3 million. But that isn't to say that the project will ever be finished. I mean, they could take that $3 million and just disappear. They could go to the Cayman Isles and just fucking retire. So it is a huge, huge gamble on the part of the pledgers. But I don't think they will. I don't think they will scam us, but it's always a risk.
It is, and I don't know what the legal ramifications are of that, because I know you're basically getting money for a certain thing. I know in the United States there are laws against getting donations under false pretenses, but most of the people who do start a Kickstarter, they are genuine, and it's just like Indiegogo and other sites. They're trying to raise money for their respective projects. I know also Shadowrun Returns, it garnered over, I think it was $2 million. And I know other projects have been successful as well. I mean, some of them are small scale and they only want to raise like $30,000. Others want to raise in the millions. So what Kickstarter essentially does, it gives them an avenue for that. And it kind of keeps the money in an escrow until the campaign is either successful or it's a dud. So if you back a campaign that doesn't actually work out, you don't actually have to pay any money. So it's an interesting system.
Yeah, I did pledge one, Class Realm. It was an education tool for just schools. It was a kind of MMO thing. So the teacher would have control. There'd be like the game master. And if a kid turned in their assignment, their teacher would give them experience points for their character. So their character could level up and be better, have better gear and all that. And I think they only wanted something like 60 grand. I can't even remember how much they wanted. And I couldn't pledge that much. I think I pledged $15. And unfortunately, it fell really, really short of its target. So I did pledge the $15, but because it didn't hit its target, they didn't need it. It wasn't taken. So a bit of a shame when they don't make them, when the good projects don't make it. But you don't lose anything as a pledger. I know places like Indiegogo, you do. If they don't reach their limit, they still take the money towards the project. But Kickstarter isn't like that. If you don't reach your limit, you don't get the money.
And I've written about this extensively on Rip10 because there have been very high profile ones and also some maybe lower scale ones that were deserving of attention. One of the things that people use Kickstarter for, and this is really interesting, is to raise money to show that there is a demand for a certain project or a certain game to come out. We'll stick to games as the example here. But considering a game developer wants to raise $100,000, that barely covers the minimum cost of making a game nowadays, unless you really go indie and go old school. I mean, game development is ridiculously expensive. You have to have a huge team of people dedicated to making the project happen. And a lot of people, what they want to do with Kickstarter is to kind of do like a market test to see who is willing, you know, not only to buy the game, but also to put money up front to see the game made. So what they do then is they take the money to venture capitalists who will invest the money, who will give them the rest of the money to get the game out there. In a lot of cases, and they even make this clear on their Kickstarter pages, this is only for a beta version of the game. This is not for the finished product. So you got to leverage your expectations when you back a Kickstarter program, because a lot of cases you're not paying for the finished game. You know, you're paying for the right to have the finished game when it comes out. Like, they'll send you the copy plus whatever perks that they've thrown in depending on your donation level.
Mm.
But in many cases, this is just their way of showing to a developer or a publisher, hey, this is what the people want. Back our project and give us more money, which I think is also a good way to do it. It kind of combines community interaction with venture capitalism. I think it works out. It could theoretically work out really good, or, you know, it could work out really bad if just nothing happens and the money gets thrown into oblivion.
Yeah, that's always that risk. And there was a high profile scam as well. I think it's for a game called Mythic. Basically, this cheeky chappy, he went along and he stole a load of concept art from other indie games and just slapped together a Kickstarter page. And he even took the pledge amounts from a different Kickstarter title and just changed the names around. And he was requesting 80 grand and people were pledging towards it. And he got like 3 grand before it was finally shut down. But, I mean, there is that risk. You got the scammers, and of course, if it doesn't turn into fruition, it's scary.
It is.
Concept.
And also the thing is, too, because Kickstarter is so popular, I know some people have started to jump on that as, you know, maybe for less, I mean, what some might consider to be less valid means. Say, for example, you know, I can't afford to pay my bills this month. I want to start a Kickstarter so I can keep my YouTube channel going, or I can keep a podcast going. I know some people have, I don't know if anyone's actually done that, but I've seen talk about it here and there. I don't know. It's one of those things where sometimes Kickstarter, and I know Angry Video Game Nerd got into some flack over this. Obviously, everyone's a critic, so you're going to get that. But I think for his movie, he raised, his initial goal was 75,000, but he ended up raising a quarter of a million. Mm. And people were like up in arms, or I think it was jealousy more than anything, but they were saying how it's e-begging, blah, blah, blah. He gets money from this source and that source. Why does he need this? You know, and also there's the fans who feel very entitled now that they've given money. You know, I paid for this project. You better deliver the goods.
Yes, yeah, that's just over-entitlement, sense of entitlement. I mean, the AVGN, you look, he's released videos of how long it takes him to make a video. And that dude deserves his sponsors and everything that he gets. I mean, he hosts his videos himself on Cinemassacre. That guy deserves to make bank, well and truly. And I'm glad that he made all that money, because I had a look at the filming diary and he's like going to proper prosthetic studios, getting custom masks made up for his movie. He's going to locations, and that guy was legit, just straight up legit. So, I mean, you will get the naysayers, and I mean, fuck him. If they don't like it, they don't need to pledge. They don't need to shit on anyone else's parade if they don't like it.
Exactly. And that's also the thing, too, that's important to note, is that some people have been critical of Kickstarter, Indiegogo, and other places as a venue for e-begging. What I think the important thing, and you touched upon it perfectly, is that it's all opt-in, opt-out. Like, there is an element of choice. If you back a project, it's because you believe in it, or you believe in the person, or you believe in the developer or the studio. You know, it's not e-begging. They're basically reaching out to the community to help fund their games. And, you know, sometimes corporate funding is not easy to come by. Even people on a smaller scale, like, you have those filmmakers who really want to get their movie out, but just due to the realities of filmmaking, it's expensive. And they need help from other people and outside sources. And Kickstarter and other similar sites, they kind of open up that avenue for them to find funding through other means. And, you know, there's always going to be people who play the e-begging card. But at the same time, it's all about choice. If I fund people, like, I'll give an example here, and this was highly controversial, was Happy Console Gamer. When he got donations for his camera, you know, people chose to do that. Like, it wasn't like he said, you know, if you don't give me money, I'm going to take my videos off and my channel will be done. I mean, that to me would be a dick move, I would think. But in this case, it was just like, I'm in a bit of a bind here. Help me if you can. And people chose to. I don't see what's wrong with that. I know opinion is divided, and I get the other side too, where they're coming from. But again, it's choice. If you don't like it, don't donate. And that's the thing. I see many Kickstarter pages with games that I'm not interested in, causes that I don't think are worth my money. And I simply move on. Like, I don't shit talk them or anything.
Yeah. I mean, Happy Console Gamer is a good example. I don't want to say I didn't approve, because fuck that. I mean, I've got an opinion. My opinion doesn't matter any more than anyone else's, but I didn't really like that. So I didn't donate. So that's a perfect example.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I can understand how some people did want to donate, and more for them. I mean, if they like something, if they think it's worth their money for future time spent, then more power to them. It's their money, their choice.
As consumers, we speak with our wallets. And, you know, what YouTube has kind of opened up as well is just this awareness of people who need different things, who want to achieve different things in life. And, I mean, without the internet, you wouldn't have the angry video game nerd. And I know many people, they look forward to his videos all the time. They look forward to every little bit of new content. And you do get it for free. I mean, it should never be an expectation that you're going to get money for it. I mean, Annie and I have talked about this kind of amongst ourselves, is that we do this podcast for free, and we have absolutely no qualms about doing it. If we were to get some residual income from ads or anything like that, I mean, that's a bonus. But, I mean, we're content to kind of toil away and do this for free just for the enjoyment of it. Some people, they have higher production value. Some people need to invest money into it. And, you know, I don't think reaching out through a Kickstarter or through a fundraising campaign is a bad move, unless the money gets misappropriated or misused for some reason. Like, if you're just saying, you know, I want to buy more games, give me more money, that I have an issue with. But if you're simply saying, you know, we want to take our podcast to the next level, you know, get all this great equipment so we can have all the sound effects and all that good stuff, you know, let the community decide if that's worthwhile.
Yeah. I mean, Far From Subtle, the guys who did the awesome video games, They had a big run-in with YouTube, unfortunately. I mean, their production values are fucking top-notch. They're really, really good. And these guys, it's their full-time job. They've got three people that just sit there and play games, record it and annotate it and just comment over it. And they release a video every single fucking day. And basically, they lived on YouTube money, and YouTube all of a sudden just took that away from them. Just said, basically, because there's kind of like a conflict with copyright, you're recording game footage. Unfortunately, you can't monetize your videos anymore. And I mean, that's three people who had invested. That was their full time job, and all of a sudden they just couldn't. That was taken away from them. And I mean, they didn't go to Kickstarter, but they tried to source alternatives like Blip TV for monetization. But I mean, if they went to Kickstarter, I think I would donate for that personally, just to keep those guys producing the videos that they enjoy and keep on pushing it out. So
yeah, because you believe in what they do.
Yeah, and they're not going to go and spend it on cheap hookers and crack cocaine. They're going to keep on releasing good content, so.
Yep, and again, that's a choice you make as a consumer. You're going to say, I'm going to back this because I believe in what they do. And, you know, there's other YouTubers I know who have kind of reached out for money at various intervals, and there's been criticism levied at them. At the end of the day, it is what it is. But kind of one of the main points we wanted to go into with this Kickstarter is because there's been some high-profile ones, including a really interesting one that just came out, well, the news kind of broke last week. And that is about the new open source Android console, which is, and forgive me if I'm pronouncing this incorrectly, it's Ouya or Ouya?
Yeah. Ouya.
Ouya.
Yep.
So, yeah, this is interesting because I'm an Android user. I know, Andy, you are as well.
Yep.
And this is actually going to be a console, which is slated for release sometime. The projected date is March the 13th. That obviously is unconfirmed, but it's going to be this console, which is pretty much open source. So much like the Android platform now, anyone can develop a game for it and release it in the online market. Now, if you're an iPhone user, you can tell the contrast because it's closed. So only approved applications from Apple can be added there. Android's different. It's pretty much open. And it's going to bring that to the console. Now, what is your opinion of the Ouya? Like, what have you read about it so far?
I would be all over that, like flies over shit, but I just can't afford it at the moment. It looks awesome. It looks really, really solid. And that's the whole idea of it, is to bring casual games back into the front room, into your living room. So they're just saying that a lot of video games, a lot of consoles at the moment, the cost is too high. I mean, you got to invest, I don't know, $200, is it, for a Xbox 360?
Minimum. Well, yeah. Unless you get the bare bones model, then you can maybe get away with like 120, 150, but 200 is more or less the minimum.
Yeah. And then you got $60 per game, and it's an astronomical cost. If you put it down on paper, just for the casual market, it's a lot of investment. So the Ouya, their whole idea is you pledge $100 and you get your console that outputs to HDMI. It's got 1080p, and you get a pad, and the pad looks like a 360 pad. Or a Wii U pad, I should say. And it's very slimline, very sexy. And their idea is that you buy this console and every game that is on their marketplace has to have a free-to-play model. If it's a demo, if it's just like the free-to-play MMO kind of model where you have to buy extra levels. The whole concept is you buy the console and you will be able to play something on it straight out of the box.
Yeah.
And The thing that really got my nerdgasm going is they've said hackers are welcome. They just want to keep it completely in open. Just if you can program your own shit onto it, you can do whatever the hell you want with your console. And that just seemed like so awesome. So, so good.
Yeah, and I think it's great too, because one thing Android users do enjoy is, you know, also the development of games is fairly easy. So if you're learning to develop games for the first time, the Android platform is fantastic for that. But also you get the benefit of playing all these great games for free. The other great thing with the hardware is that, you know, it kind of brings that to your TV. So you're not just confined with, you know, playing it on your little device. And I know out of the box, they're going to have some games that are optimized just for the Ouya. But here are some of the specs for it. And I think this actually is a great value added thing as well. It's got a gig of RAM. It's got 8 gigabytes of internal flash memory. It does support Bluetooth. It does support Wi-Fi. And it's going to be running the Ice Cream Sandwich operating system. So it's pretty much going to be top of the line by Android standards. Now, again, this comes out in 2013, so we're not sure 100% when that's going to be. But I was reading about this, and I was intrigued, because considering how popular mobile games have gotten and also how cost prohibitive for some that retail games have gotten, this kind of strikes that happy balance, because though some people like to play games on their TV, some people like the console experience versus the mobile experience. I'm one of those people. Like, I'm not big into mobile games as much as I am with console games. This kind of bridges that gap, and I think it's going to drive some really good competition, because if I could play a console game that costs $1 or is free versus a $60 game, I mean, outside of the ones that I really want, that's interesting. I like that. I like that idea a lot, actually.
Yeah, and I mean, you're not the only person that's been very responsive to this. I mean, their goal was just shy of 1 million. They wanted 950,000, and they exceeded that within the first 8 hours, I think, of going live. They buried it, and they're currently sitting just shy of $5 million, and they still got 24 days left.
It's incredible. Now, how much do you want to bet? This is interesting, because what a lot of people use their Android phones for, I know there's some really good Super Nintendo emulators on there and also other console emulators. It's going to become an emulator platform, I think, for a lot of people. So, you know, those of you who have been purchasing games on the virtual console, you may have less incentive to do so. And those of you who've been wanting to play, you know, Nintendo, Super Nintendo, N64, Genesis, any of those games on your TV, it's going to be a lot easier now, since you would have an Ouya that you can just kind of load it up with your ROMs and just get a decent quality emulator. And there's a bunch of them on the Google Play marketplace.
Yeah, that's one of the things that a lot of people have been very talkative about, is the emulator scene. And they've said that they don't see any problems with it. It should be shortly after launch that all these emulators will be released. So, I mean, You could just play Super Mario Bros. On your TV the way it should have been, without Virtual Console, without any of that malarkey. The legality of that, I'm not too sure of, if there are any copyright infringements. Yeah.
Well, there most definitely is. I mean, let's put it that way. You're using a licensed product on another platform. I think how they're going to regulate that, like, they haven't really done much to regulate it with the Android mobiles. I mean, I know so many people who have a Super Nintendo emulator, and they're easy to get. You can get even, because what is it I downloaded? I downloaded an Atari one the other day, which had a bunch of Atari games on it. So I don't know where the legality falls with this. Maybe mobile gaming is just that frontier that they haven't been able to regulate to the extent that a home console would be. I don't know. I mean, I can see, kind of in light of the success of the Ouya, is that the developers who are jilted by this, or the companies that are jilted by this, they're probably going to come after them, and maybe they'll block a couple of the copyrighted elements. I don't know. It's possible. But again, with an open platform like that, it's difficult to do, because one gets blocked, another will just pop up.
Yeah, I mean, as far as I'm aware, the actual emulators themselves are perfectly legal. It's whether or not you pirate the ROMs. So, I don't know. It should be fine. I'm hoping it's fine. And I've just brought up the Kickstarter here. And, man, I've got to find a way to get this. I do want it. I mean, I know Notch, for the guy who made Minecraft.
Mm-hmm.
He says if there's enough interest, he'll release Minecraft on it. So I think that'll get right up Microsoft's butt. He jumped into bed with Microsoft for the Xbox, and if he turns around and just says, yeah, Minecraft on the Ouya, I think that might piss him off a little bit.
Well, keep in mind, they don't have an exclusive agreement with Microsoft, because, I mean, they have Minecraft on mobile, they have Minecraft on PC and Xbox. I mean, the Xbox 360 version was a port.
Mm.
And, I mean, the opinion amongst, you know, the experienced people who played Minecraft on PC is that it's a very dumbed down, very limited port compared to what you can get on the PC. And I agree with it. I mean, I played it, and it definitely feels confined compared to, you know, all the servers and all the different possibilities you can get with the PC version. Releasing it on the Ouya will not have the same encumbrances as the Xbox Live, because that's a closed platform. On the Ouya, they could probably release a full version of the game and just have probably easier PC connectivity. So I see that being very successful. And if they were to have that at launch, it would give it a big boost.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they'll have it at launch, but that's a very good point that you brought up. I mean, Microsoft are very stringent. You can't patch your game very easily. It's got to go through Microsoft Quality Assurance. I think you get your first patch for free. Any other patches, you have to pay like $15,000 for them, if memory serves. So with the Ouya, if it's an open platform, there'll be no quality assurance, and there'll be no fees for patching your product. So Minecraft, they could keep up with the PC update schedule.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a very good point, actually.
And I think it would just benefit everyone. I think the Ouya, I mean, because here's the thing. With the Wii U, I can almost, my prediction is that will be $300 at launch or over. I'm thinking maybe even $350 with the controller. $100 for a launch console, I think that, and given all the specs that you get with it, and given all the different elements that they provide with it, that makes it a pretty easy decision for some people.
Yeah.
Myself included, because, I mean, I'm an Android user, so, I mean, maybe I can sync it with my Android phone and do something interesting with that. Who knows? I mean, I like the idea of it, and the $100, I mean, if the system turns out to be an absolute turd, because really, it's great in theory now, how is it going to work? That's really the question. I've only lost $100. If I buy a Wii U and I can't stand it, I'm out $350 or whatever I can get in trade value.
Yeah, that's just one thing for us, actually, because we're outside of the US. We have to pay an extra $20. So if you're in the US, you get it for $100 on the dot delivered. If you're in Canada or the UK, $120.
Still, that's pretty decent.
You can't really argue with that. Sending a console halfway around the world for us for $20 is actually pretty good.
But yeah, I mean, being in Canada, you tend to feel a little ripped off, though, because the cost of sending things to Canada is not that much more expensive than the U.S. The only thing you have to worry about is maybe customs and duty, but that's rarely an issue.
You said duty.
Duty. Duty. We're so mature.
Yeah, what were we talking about again?
we're talking about the Ouya. I mean, we're having a serious conversation about Kickstarter, but in true Rad Rascals fashion, we just derailed it with talk about poop.
But yeah, I mean, $100. If it does blow up and it is a piece of shit, then you haven't really lost anything. You can turn it into like a media player, pretty much like the original Xbox. And the original Xbox, a lot of people didn't really like the games on it, so they just turned it into the Xbox Media Center, and it was very popular for that. So for the Ouya, I mean, $100, you could turn it into a whatever the fuck you want. You can just put your movies on there, just play it 1080p straight up.
My red tube in 1080p. I can't wait.
Yeah. It'll be good. And it looks like it's wipe proof as well. So if you do make a mess, you can just wipe it off.
Exactly. It's got that nice, like, chrome looking finish on it, too. So if I get a little bit excited and things happen, it's nice to know my console will not endure any long lasting damage. Now, the other thing to consider, too, is that if this console doesn't fly, like, it's not the success. I mean, the Kickstarter is a good early indication that it will be successful. I mean, that much money in that short a period of time.
Mm.
That's impressive by any standard. If the system doesn't do well, it'll be a collector's item because they're not going to produce them if it doesn't sell.
Yeah.
So it could be a collector's item in the future. I know there's some consoles that they had high hopes for. They were just absolute turds, and then they just stopped producing them, making the original models a collector's item. So who knows? I mean, the Ouya at this point is just it's in development. We know it's going to be there eventually. I hope my honest hope is what they achieve from it is maybe giving a wake-up call to Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo that you're overcharging and that people will go to cheaper alternatives for the games that they want. Because let's face it, you know, your love of draw something or draw, is it draw anything or draw something?
Draw something, yeah.
Yeah, your love of draw something and various other people getting into games like Angry Birds and Fruit Ninja and other games like that, it shows that people enjoy casual games and they enjoy mobile games, and often they're a good alternative to having to spend $60 on a game that you can just wait a few months for it to go down in price. So hopefully this maybe shows them that, hey, if you don't give the goods and you don't give them at the price they want, people are going to go elsewhere.
Yeah,
that's a hope.
That's a good point. It could be a very good wake-up call for the industry.
It'll shake things up, because let's face it, mobile gaming is not just a fringe thing. It's pretty much, I see people playing iPad games all the time in public and on their phones, and, you know, it gives you an experience that just people are going to start migrating away from consoles. I mean, not completely. You're going to have people like us who still love console gaming, but I don't know. I think this kind of brings mobile gaming to the home console experience, so it amalgamates both.
Yeah. Will you be back in it, do you reckon?
I think I will. I mean, $100 is not a lot of money. I mean, at certain times it can be, but considering I'd be getting a console for it, you know, I can't really argue with that. And plus, it'll be a great thing to kind of write about when I finally get it. Like, I can write articles on the Ouya and what my experiences are. And, you know, whether it sinks or swims, I've still had a good experience. I've had, or at least an interesting experience with it.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm due a tax rebate. If I get it this month, I think I will. I'll invest. I mean, I'm 3 weeks out from the wedding now, so I mean, shit is getting very real very quick. But as soon as payday comes round, if I've got a little bit of money, I think I might.
Yeah, I mean, the prospect of a new console definitely helps offset the pre-wedding jitters. It's a proven fact.
Yeah. I'm just thinking, man. Just, I could have an N64 emulator. And I can play Mystical Ninja starring Goemon. And it'll be awesome.
Exactly. And I can play Shadowgate 64 on my big screen TV. My dreams are becoming true. It's unbelievable.
I did like the, is it $225 pledge? You get two controllers with your username etched into the controllers, which looks pretty pimpin'.
That is pretty sweet. That'll tell people, hey, this was Ben's controller. Yeah. You better not touch it without sanitizing first. No,
disgusting.
Well, what else would you expect from me? Come on. But yeah, that's Kickstarter in a nutshell. I mean, it's become incredibly popular not just in gaming. I did point out, for example, Jason Heine. He is trying to get distribution for his album. So if he raises $3,000, and what he's offering as incentives, he's offering obviously a copy of the album, signed posters, his back discography, And other little things like, you know, like drum keys and drumsticks, just little knickknacks that if you're a fan of his music or a fan of his YouTube show, they'd be nice to have. And, you know, he's someone I've known for a while, and whether his music is to your taste or not, he's definitely someone who has the passion for it. So I did back his Kickstarter project. I couldn't afford to give a lot, but certainly I felt it worthwhile to back it. And for that, I'll be getting a physical CD to add to my collection. So,
sweet. I mean, you're in desperate need of CDs, man, because your collection is pretty meager, you have to admit. So,
yep. 5,000 is just a pittance. It's pathetic.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, why do you even bother, mate? You can't even call it a collection, to be fair.
Exactly. I say the same thing to Pete Dore. You know, you're in desperate need of games. There's not enough in your room. Like, it looks so sparse.
Yeah.
Same thing with my CDs. Like, it's desolation. But yes, I'll have one more to add to it. So that's something to look forward to. So yeah, definitely a little plug for that. Definitely, if you're interested, go to Jason Heine's Facebook or his YouTube page and check out his Kickstarter. His music, I mean, it's kind of like a mix of like funk, rap, almost Eminem like spoken word. I enjoy it. You know, it definitely, I mean, but also, you know, the guy, so it's, I don't know, like, I like it, and I definitely felt it worth backing, and plus, he's a musician, and, you know, it's a struggle to get your stuff out there, especially if you're doing it independently, so I definitely enjoyed backing that, and the same with any games out there. I mean, I know a few people have been backing quite a few Kickstarter projects lately, and sometimes the threshold is so low, it's just 10, 20 bucks here. So definitely recommend checking out. It's an interesting new frontier for people to get their games out there and also to kind of have community participation, because with some games, it's interesting. They'll actually give you things like, I don't know, what will they give you? They'll make you like a playable character in the game, or they'll put you in the credits, or in one case, they actually, I forget which game this was, but it's a military shooter. The top incentive, if you donate over $10,000, you get to have lunch with the developers, and then they go to a shooting range to fire off all their guns.
The ones for Wasteland 2 were pretty awesome. I mean, my pledge, I get the beta, I get the game digital copy of it for Steam. Mm-hmm. I get a physical big box version. So you remember how the old PC games came? They were in the big box. And I loved those, man. I remember, like, Fallout 2. I got that in a big box. You get a big fuck-off huge manual. It was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm getting something like that. I'm in the credits as well, and it's awesome. But the higher you go up in the tiers, you become, like, a NPC. And a few of them, the old one, the high ones, you get to, like, name a gun. And you get a shrine and stuff like that in the game. It's awesome, man.
Yeah, and that's the thing. As someone who's backing it, you do get kind of the cream of the crop and also some rare exclusives. I mean, if that game really takes off and you have some of the Kickstarter bonuses, I mean, that can definitely add value to what you have.
Yeah, I mean, because I get a digital copy of the game, I won't be opening my big box version because there will only be a couple of thousand of them and there won't be that many in England. So if I could just keep it unopened, I can still enjoy the game as it's meant to be played, but I can still keep kind of like this sealed, awesome box of fucking cool shit for a rainy day. So, man, I'm looking forward to it. I just have the thing about Kickstarter, the worst part for me is because you've got to put your money up front. The wait is unbelievable. At the earliest, it'll be October 2013. So, that's a long, slow fucking wait, man. I'm masturbating very slowly. I'm pacing myself for this game, and then when it finally gets released, I'll be released. And as we talked about it last episode, it'll be like Randy in the
South Park.
Yeah, it will. Wasteland 2, man. I'm telling you. I just have to say, sorry, a correction. Eric, he didn't pledge $15. He pledged 50 because he's a man, and that's what manly men do.
Yeah, no $15 pledges here. It's 50 or get the fuck out.
Yeah, so me and Eric, we've backed Wasteland 2, and it'll be the best game ever released. If it isn't, I'll just commit suicide. My life won't be worth living anymore.
Exactly. He spent a year and a half, you know, as he said, masturbating slowly, and not like the fapping, but just the jiggling, you know, lightly going... You know, just waiting for the game to come out. If it's disappointing, it is going to be the anti-climax of all anti-climaxes.
Yeah, I'll just go out. I won't say a word. I'll just go out silently into the woods and hang myself.
If this podcast suddenly comes to an abrupt end in October 2013, you'll know why.
Yep. But it won't. It'll be awesome. And they're releasing, get this, a screenshot of the work in progress this week, apparently. And I have not been this excited for a video game since I was a kid. You know, when you were a kid, you'd open up the magazines and you'd see these games coming out like a sequel. You loved the original and you were convinced that the sequel would be the best thing ever made. So mm-hmm. you'd pore over every screenshot and you'd be so happy and you'd look forward to it so much. And it's been a very, very long time since I've been this excited for a game. So Wasteland 2, man, I just can't wait.
Yep, it's going to be a long year ahead. And I think every podcast up until that point, we're going to have to mention Wasteland 2 at least once.
Yep, God Hand, Wasteland 2, Deadly Premonition, Nier. We'll have just a collective of games that we have to mention every fucking podcast.
Yep, and hey, I'm happy to do it too, because anything that gets awareness to God Hand is good in my books. Deadly Premonition, I've yet to start. The other games... But hey, I'm all about entertaining these childish impulses that we have. So yes, definitely Wasteland 2 is the one to look forward to. And I mean, by then I should have a decent PC, better by that time, because that's a year and a half away. So that's definitely not an unattainable goal. But by then I hope to be playing it too. So maybe when the podcast time rolls around, I'm calling it now, actually. October 2013, we will talk about Wasteland 2 and we will both be playing it.
I'm going to make a note of that. What is this? So it's just after an hour into the podcast. Mm-hmm. So Ben promises
mm-hmm.
if he doesn't play it, he will go for a transgender operation and we'll have to call him Ben Rena.
Ben Rena?
I don't know. What's the female name of Ben?
I don't know if there is one, actually.
We'll call you Beth.
Beth. There. That makes me sound like a butch lesbian. Beth. I don't know. I have to pick something which doesn't it doesn't sound too manly. I don't know. But hey, I'm all for the other part of it. We'll definitely hold true to that. So if you hear me starting to talk in a little bit more of a soprano tone around that time, you'll know that I definitely didn't fulfill my end of the bargain.
Yeah, you're under the hormone replacement tablets.
Yes. So I'll be like, welcome to the Rad Rascals podcast.
You do the perfect impression of Jim Carrey right there.
Yes. How about some booty cutie?
So. I don't know, man. I hope you don't play it. So you do go for the transgender operation.
Okay, can you realize how unnerving it's going to be for our guest when it's like, and now I'd like to introduce our guest, the super sexy Eric. I think people would abandon our podcast very quickly.
Or we might get a whole brand new crowd in. You never know.
Exactly. People start showing pictures of their post-ops procedures, and I'm like, oh, yes, I support you in spirit. And I'll be saying to myself, why the fuck didn't I play Wasteland 2 when I said I would? It's always, okay, this is the thing. I'm so shy about committing to anything these days because, well, especially gaming-related, simply put, because it's hard to pull through on it. The Gentleman's Challenge is a testament to this.
Mm.
Because I have been a two-time rascal thus far. Two times.
That's not good, man.
And I have to redeem myself. The summer backlog is kicking my ass a little bit, and I'll go into what game I played from that when we go into the games we've been playing segment. But it's easy to commit to certain things with gaming, but it's really hard to pull through on them because games are a huge time commitment. And plus, there's things that sidetrack us. I mean, if you start the Gentleman's Challenge in September when Borderlands 2 comes out, I may have to fly to England and kick you in the dick.
I'm actually going to do that.
I know. By saying that, I've just invited you to do that.
You know me. Anything to be an arsehole, I'll do it.
Well, hey, we do a podcast together for a reason, because we're both equal opportunity assholes. So some we stretch a little further than others, but hey, that's what we do. So, yes. And Andy's trying to think of how he can respond to that without gagging.
So, yep.
Not, there isn't much that makes Andy gag these days.
Nope. I mean... God damn it. Filthy, filthy fucker.
This is when you know we're getting back to the right track, when Andy's just all he can say is dirty, dirty fucker.
Yeah, I just need to touch upon this because I'm under serious risk of becoming a rascal myself for the summer backlog challenge. That's kicking my ass. I only had 3 games, and I haven't touched them, man. I have not fucking touched them.
It is difficult, and the problem is that what you feel like you're going to be able to play at the time is not what you're going to feel like playing even the next day or the next week. So, I mean, for me, I'm looking at my pile. I did complete Red Faction Armageddon, and, I mean, I have other ones like Catherine, Rage, Riddick, and Deadly Premonition. I'm like, between now and September, how am I going to get these out of the way when other games are just going to keep distracting me? And not just games, but real life as well.
Mm.
I mean, Andy, a wedding is not a small thing. I don't think you're going to be having much time for gaming on your honeymoon. At least I hope not.
No, I think that would be a very quick divorce. And actually, that might be a record for wedding to funeral. If I took the PSP or whatever on the honeymoon, I think she would kill me.
You would be found like by the local police, just with like the PSP just shoved down your throat.
Or up my ass. Whichever one takes her fancy at the time.
No, that'll be your 3DS. You'll bring both and she'll do the airtight. Yep. Hey, a fitting end for a gamer, if ever there was one.
Yeah, but that's a good point.
Yes. So that's the thing with these challenges. I know, like, I haven't been following the community as closely as maybe I should, but I want to kind of check in with other people. And this actually maybe opens up the floor a little bit. If you are one of the people listening who has taken part in the Summer Backlog Challenge, how are you doing? Are you getting through your games? I know Comeback Kid is making some pretty good progress, but he picked 10 games.
Ooh.
I'm like, I could never do that. Even five for me is a stretch. I should have maybe played it more conservative and stuck to 3, but alas, I made my choice. But anyone listening, how are you doing so far? Have you made progress? Are you struggling? You know, let's check in. We're almost midway through. Yeah, let's talk about it. So how have you been doing with your Summer Backlog Challenge? And maybe we can motivate each other to kind of kick it into high gear.
Yeah, I think I've just I've made peace with the fact that I'll probably be a rascal. Well, I will. I mean, I've got no inclination to go back and play Skyward Sword. The Yakuza game, it's all right in small doses, but I don't know. I'm just reading at the moment, man. I'll tell you, when it comes to the stuff we've been watching recently, I'll mention a few of the books I've been reading, if you don't mind.
No, not at all. I don't read books. I ever since me and education have parted company, literature.
I've only just recently gotten into it, and it's because of Game of Thrones, something that you have yet to watch, I believe. So you're a bastard, and I don't like you.
Isn't that a line from one of the first episodes? It's like, that is what you are, a bastard. Make peace with it.
Yep. I mean, that bastard's it's a common theme in A Song of Ice and Fire. Lots of bastards. Lots of bastards.
So I'm fitting the mold, essentially. Well, yeah. In spirit, I'm fitting into it. There we go. Hey, that's a start. But no, I'm just joking. Of course, I do enjoy reading as well. And we'll cover that a little bit. Actually, we'll do a book segment. Why not? While we're on the fly. But I think we pretty much discussed everything with Kickstarter. Anything else you wanted to add before we move on to the next segment?
Yeah, actually. Mention it if there are any decent Kickstarters out there that you think deserve our attention.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, personally, I want to stick to the gaming ones. I'm not too interested in the movies, the albums, or the books, or the Brony. Get this, you know those fucking My Little Ponies?
I am aware of them, yes.
Yeah, so they call themselves Bronies, I believe.
The hell you say?
Yeah, and these fuckers, these absolute fuckers, have started a Kickstarter or an Indiegogo to create their own island, a Brony Island.
Okay, that sound you hear is not me reaching for my credit card.
you've already got it on Amazon. You've logged in. Da, 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 da. I've got my money. Take all my money. Take it.
I've got my credit card in one hand and Lubriderm in the other. I'm just ready to rock.
Cock in one hand and fucking credentials in the other.
Exactly. Double C right there.
But yeah, I mean, Kickstarter, it's a double-edged sword. There are some really cool projects, and then you get other ones like Brony Island that I just hope fail. I mean, I know it's their money. They can do whatever they want with it. Actually, no, fuck it. I hope they succeed, and all the Bronies go there with the Beliebers and all those fuckers, and then we can just nuke that island. It'll be perfect.
I don't know. We need a much bigger island for the Beliebers, I think. And here's the thing, actually, I said this one time, you know, I know our friend Eric, he's all about the zombie apocalypse. He said he would welcome it because he's got all the guns, he's got all the cars and everything. He'll be rocking it Tarantino style should there ever be a zombie apocalypse. My approach is that if we're ever in that situation, I'm going to hide out with the believers. You know why? Because the zombies like to eat brains. That is the last fucking place they're going to look.
Yep.
Exactly. But with the bronies, they can have their own. Okay, so do they actually want to have their own island? Like an actual physical island?
Yeah, as far as I'm aware, some nutcase created a Kickstarter to create Brony Island. And I don't know if it's going to be a theme park that's Brony inspired or if they just want to go over there and suck each other's cucks while dressed up as horses. I don't know. But they want to create their own island.
Like, I'm just looking at this. There's a documentary project called Music is Magic, a documentary on Brony music. Let's see, Brony Island. Let's see here. BronyCon. There we go.
I know there's like the conference for it, but I'm pretty sure they want to create their own island.
Well, BronyCon, a documentary, they have 2,621 backers, $322,022. It was a successful campaign. I don't know.
They've called it the Island of Equestria Project.
Let's see here. It's on the Escapist now. Let's see here. I can just picture like the Brony orgies.
I'm looking at this thread, and
is that on the Escapist website?
No, it's fucking mlponies.com, and I can't hate them for it. I really can't, because they've got one of the My Little Ponies, I think it is, but there's an Adventure Time episode where there's a horse, and the horse is just staring at Finn and Jake,
mm-hmm.
and. And they can't sleep because this fucking horse is staring at them. So they go over and they try and talk to it. And whenever they talk to it, it just does like a mouth fart. It just goes. And Jake says, "Aw, man, leave it. This horse is whack. It's got poo brain." And some guy on this forum has created a poo brain My Little Pony, like little avatar. And it looks awesome.
Yeah. Okay, well, here's the thing. The Island of Equestria, that's what it's called, right?
Mm.
It's actually on Indiegogo.
Ah, okay.
And here we go. This is what it has, okay? They are going to create what needs to happen. The goal is to set a campaign the bare minimum to purchase a decently sized island and construct the structure mentioned above, which is going to be like a monolith of some kind. So picture 2001 A Space Odyssey with all the apes kind of rubbing the big monolith. You know, that'll just be bronies rubbing a giant penis or something. Decent-sized island, construct the structure mentioned above, as well as acquire any appropriate licensing from copyright holders should it be required. Any funds above the required amount will go towards a larger island and constructing more and better structures on the island. Now, their goal is to raise $600,000 for this. Now, I don't even know if you could buy a patch of dirt for that, but regardless. The total amount is $130. That's how much they've raised. So
from 15 people, 15 funders.
Exactly. So it seems like bronies have the passion, but they lack the deep pockets required to get this project off the ground.
That is bad.
That is comedy. Now, okay, let's see what you get here, though. If you do back it, now, if any of you are listening who are into My Little Pony Friendship is Magic, we're not judging. And if you think this idea is good, let me tell you what you're going to get. For $7,500, you will become Celestia. And that means, this is the top amount, okay? We will value your input on everything from planning and the construction of the island. You will have input on everything from how the structures look to where you put them on the island. In addition to this, you'll receive all previous perks. I want to donate this just so I can tell them to put penises everywhere. Now, for $5,000, you will receive a personal tour of the island, a week-long campout, and all previous perks. Now, this is, of course, assuming the island actually exists. Now, but these are mere technicalities here. For $1,000, you will be Cadence, and in addition to the previous perks, you will be given a grand tour of the island once it's completed, or prior to completion at request, so you can just swim around it. You will also be invited to a week-long campout with others who meet this who met this perk, less travel expense depending on your geographical location. You will also get progress pictures emailed to you, as well as be kept up to date with the island's construction and status on a permanent basis. Now, if you want to play it safe, $500, you can be captain of the Royal Guard. Your name will be listed on a plaque placed on the island to commemorate your generosity. Now, if you want to donate less, maybe $500 is too much for you, $250 might make you a royal camper, as they call it, and that gives you an invitation to a three-day campout on the island upon completion. This does not include travel expenses beyond the boat ride between the nearest dock and the island itself. So basically what they're going to do, they're going to get like a little dinghy and make you swim behind it. And for $100 for the Royal Guard, a framed picture of the completed monument will be mailed to you. Also include the $5 perk, which is called the Royal Student, and that is a picture of the completed Summer Sun Celebration Monument will be mailed to you upon completion. Now, for $5 as a student, a set of pictures taken on the island will be emailed to you once the monuments and the structures are complete. And for $1, they'll keep you updated on what's happening. So, and at the rate of $130 with 15 backers, they're just not going to email you anything. It's going to be nothing.
I'm crying here. I just read. The thing that got me laughing was the $50, and they've actually got a backer. This guy, remember, Indiegogo, it doesn't matter if it reaches its target or not. If you pledge $50, you've lost that $50. Mm-hmm. This guy will be given $50 to get a picture of a fictional monument.
Exactly, and I'm looking at the picture of the guy too. I don't want to name him, like, just that would be a little bit dickish, but he looks the brony part. So if you are a brony, definitely go to indiegogo.com/equestria, that's EQUESTRIA, and pledge your money. Now, 9 people have pledged $5, 1 person 50, and none of the amounts above that. Well, three have donated $1, so.
And you better hurry, because you've only got 50 days left at the time of recording, so.
Yes, supplies are limited. Please call now for your Island of Equestria.
Man, I was crying. I was just the idea of spending $50 for a fucking picture of a fucking place that will never exist. But some people.
For $1,000, you can have a camp out on a fictional island of a place that doesn't exist.
Oh, man.
See, this has got to be for shits and giggles. Mind you, it wouldn't surprise me if the person who created this is actually serious.
Yeah, I mean, that's the sad thing. A fool and his money are very easily parted. And
So if you're a fool and what you heard appeals to you, definitely sign up. But again, no judgment to bronies. Hey, everyone is entitled to like what they like.
Yeah, Mom, I hope it does succeed and you can have your island and you can enjoy it and it will bring you much happiness.
How much do you want to bet that this island is just going to be like made out of Lego with like pictures on a cell phone camera?
Yeah, if it does become an island, I think it'll be in the middle of a lake somewhere, and it'll just be a couple of oil drums, like, duct taped together with a flag on it. And the monument, yeah, they'll just take a picture of the flag and call it a monument. And your three-day camp out, well, you better bring your own swimming aids, because it probably won't take the weight of anyone.
Exactly, you'll just have to bring your own inflatable raft.
Oh, man.
There you go. Hey. This is the funny thing, the internet attracts all kinds.
Yeah, unfortunately so.
Okay, so that is our Kickstarter segment. Hopefully you enjoyed that little detour that we made into Brony territory. Actually, we should put Brony in the title just to see how many hits we get. Actually, this is a good idea. Last week, we put Penis in the title, and that led to an explosion, so to speak, of page views. Wonder what would happen if we put Brony in there.
Brony Island. I don't know.
Yes. How about Super Brony Island? Like, this is like a video game nod. Well, we'll see. We'll see. But that's one idea. But let's troll a little bit and just kind of see how we do. Okay, so that is Kickstarter. Definitely we had some serious and some not so serious discussions, but that is the nature of the Rad Rascals. So shall we move on to the next segment, Andy? Or is this just one of those, just one more thing?
No, I was just thinking, from Kickstarter to Catstarter.
Catstarter, yes. We are going to bring back the cat segment because I think, honestly, it works. People like it. And as long as we have stories to tell, it's a segment that's going to continue. Now, before I get into the truly revolting story, let's hear from Andy. Andy, good sir, tell me how are Raptor and Rascal doing? Is your dick healed?
Yep, there have been no scratchings this week, thank God. But however, Rascal did decide to jump out of the window this afternoon. Oh. Which would be fine, but we're on the first floor, so she had about a 10-foot drop. But she landed in a bush, she was all right, and it was all cool. But I did meet a very interesting cat yesterday. I went to a farmhouse for a party, a bit of a box social, if you will. Mm-hmm. And I was chatting to the people, and there's this ginger cat. It was very affectionate, and I talked to the owners, and they hated this cat. They didn't even give it a name. They fed it. It pissed off. It went outside, and it was its own animal. Mm-hmm. And I said, "What's its name?" And they said, "It doesn't have a name. We call it Ginger." And I was like, "Oh, okay." And they told me a bit of its story, and it was a cat that belonged to a heroin addict, apparently. And the heroin addict said that they needed to go to rehab, but they couldn't because they had a cat. So would the people mind looking after their cat for a week? And after a week, they'd be in rehab. Hopefully, they'll be in a better position to take care of it. And that was 5 years ago.
Yeah, I was about to say rehab for 1 week sounds pretty ambitious.
Yep. The heroin addict never even went close to rehab. They just ditched their cat on someone. So I had the cat, and I was at this party. It was a leaving do for one of my close friends, and I mean, they were drinking, they were smoking, they were having a whirl of a time, and then there's me just in a corner with a ginger cat on my lap.
Hey, a ginger cat is all the party you need. Drink, drugs, any of that stuff, you got a cat.
Yeah, I got pussy at the end of the day. I went to the party and I got some pussy, so I was happy.
Ginger pussy, no less.
Yeah, I don't discriminate, man. Ginger pussy. I got to be careful of my word in here because I wanted to say black pussy.
Whoa, gay sugar.
Yeah. Give me some brown sugar, lovely. I don't discriminate, man.
Yep. I mean, ginger pussy, I know what I'm going to... Okay, as a wedding gift, since you love ginger so much, I'm going to send you a nice big Ron Weasley poster. Since you love ginger pussy so much.
Just wipe it down first for me, yeah?
It'll be laminated, so it'll be easy to come off, so yeah. To speak.
White proof.
Exactly.
So it'd be easy to come on and easy to come off.
Exactly. So instead of drink, drugs, Andy enjoyed his ginger pussy very much.
Yeah, it was good, man. It was good. But I got back and... I mean, cats are horrifically territorial, and they smelt this ginger pussy. So I walked through the door, and Caroline was like, "Oh my God, you've been seeing other women." And my cats were like, "Oh my God, you've been seeing other cats."
So in the Andy Caroline house, Andy is now branded as the filthy, filthy whore.
Yeah, from both my wife-to-be and my cats. None of them are speaking to me. They're all mad.
And how sad is it that they're both 100% right?
Yep.
Yes. Yeah, so Andy went to a party, had some ginger poontang, and it was all good. But no. But I mean, the cat was affectionate. It was nice.
Yeah, the cat. It was very nice. I mean, they didn't really stroke it. They fed it. They didn't mistreat it in any shape or form. I don't want to give you that impression. They looked after the cat. It was very, very healthy. But they had another cat that was their cat and that got all the attention, and it was an attention whore. So this ginger cat, or Ginger, as they called it, it just needed a bit of TLC. I was a shoulder to cry on and a lap to lie on. So it was good. It was a one-night affair.
Yes, one that may one day be repeated, who knows? But I mean, I have a ginger cat too, and he is like the most affectionate little bugger you can imagine. Like he, funny thing is, he won't even leave you alone. You give him the slightest amount of attention, he will follow you for days. Like literally, he will not leave you alone. Like you close your door between him, he'll scratch at it, meow at it. He'll be constantly rubbing up in your face, and he has this tendency. You mentioned your cat Link had the same kind of weird oddball quirk where it's just their ass always needs to connect with your face.
Yeah,
that's exactly. And Finn is no different. Like he will get his butthole right up in your face.
The thing is, and I don't want to be gross, I don't want to be that dude, but Link, I don't know how the fuck she managed it, but her asshole was huge, man. It was like, I called her Full Moon, and fucking hell, she would just rub up, and then all of a sudden, Full Moon right in your face. And actually, Rascal this morning came over to me and farted on me. Goddamn little shit. Just fucking farted. So we're lucky that Link had never farted in my face with Full Moon, because I don't know what I'd do, man. I do not know.
I'm just picturing, like, I don't know if you remember this, but there was this old advertisement for, like, Maxell cassette tapes where a guy's sitting in a chair, and there's this gust of wind that's blowing him backwards, and, like, his drink is spilling over.
Yeah, is that the one in the armchair with the lampshade, and he's got the glasses on.
Exactly, and everything's kind of flying backwards. That it would have been something like that.
Yeah, it would have been an experience.
Exactly. Link smiled at me sideways and then blew me a kiss.
That is disgusting.
Hey, you just talked about cat farts and large cat assholes, okay? I don't think I'm the only one. I don't think I'm the only guilty party in this. But I do have a story to tell, which is equally revolting. I'd say even more. And it actually ties into what Andy said about cats being very territorial. Now, if you have a cat and a dog together, usually they get along. Now, I know the old adage is cats and dogs don't mix. One chases the other, one hates the other. Actually, that's pretty far from the truth, at least in my experience. Dogs and cats get along pretty harmoniously. Cats and cats, that's a different story. And I found this out actually just on Friday, because we've been having a major heat wave in Toronto. It's been going on for weeks, actually. I know almost every week on the podcast I complain about the heat, but it's just been unusually hot and consistently hot, and I've been using the air conditioning a lot because we have central air that blows through the whole house. Lately, I've been finding that whenever I turn on the air conditioner, there's like this faint smell of cat turds that kind of go through the whole house. It's not overpowering. It's not like you're like, oh my God, it smells like a cat's rectum in here, but it's the smell of poop kind of goes through the house. And I was wondering what the hell, because we keep the litter box well away from the vent. We have two cats. They both use the litter box. Now, I should have put two and two together before, because I clean out the cat box daily, because you can't leave that shit sitting around.
Yeah.
So I clean it out daily, but I always wondered how come there's not a lot in here, because we have two cats who eat a fair and hearty amount. That should be like a row of sausages in there. I should be cleaning it out daily. But there wasn't a lot in there. And there was only really enough from one cat. So I was starting to wonder, okay, is one of them maybe sick? Is one of them maybe not using the box? But I couldn't find anything. But then the smell started wafting through the house a little bit. But it was like a faint smell. But you couldn't mistake it for anything else. It was cat crap. So I was looking around. And one thing I realized is that my cat Finn is the territory holder. Like, he's the one who stakes his claim over the... You know, you have the cats running for the food bowl. One will always get to it first. And one will always kind of kick the other cat off when they want to sleep in the desirable chair or the location that's the most comfortable. That's just how cats are. I found out that my cat Olivia, the little black one, she hasn't been using the litter box. She has been pooping in another corner of the basement. And how did I find this out? I moved a couple of boxes that were beside the furnace, which is where we have the central air thing, and right under the intake vent. There was, I kid you not, this almost perfect pyramid of cat shit. Olivia had been pooping in that corner for God knows how long, and I'm not going to post a picture of this. Don't even ask, because that is just revolting. But it was almost like a perfect pyramid. Like, it was a work of art, I have to say, that this cat was able to squeeze that out. But, I mean, it was just like, and it wasn't even small, too. Like, I don't even know what I could compare it to. It was maybe as tall as a bottle of wine. And as wide as... I'm struggling for an analogy here, but it was big. Just take my word for it.
You can imagine if it is a pyramid and it is as tall as a bottle of wine.
Yeah, those of you who are math majors can kind of figure out maybe the circumference of it just from that, but it was big. and it was almost perfectly formed too. And I looked at it, and then my cat Olivia was sitting there and giving me the evil eye, almost like, get out of the bathroom, I need to use it. So right under the intake where the air conditioner was going, there was a pyramid of cat crap. So I've been breathing in cat crap fumes for God knows how long.
And I mean, for people that don't have cats, I mean, when they use the litter, you go straight away to clean it. I mean, you scoop it straight away.
You have to. And the reason being is that, because also their urine is very strong, you can get what's called, I think it's called toxoplasmosis or something. It's like some really bad illnesses from that. And that's also bad for the cats, too. So you clean it out, everyone's happy. And plus, it means you don't have a big job to deal with at the end of the day, too. So.
Yeah, I mean, just the smell alone will just, it will inspire you. Even if you're the most demotivated person in the world, if a cat shits in a litter box, you clean it straight away. You got no choice. The exactly. smell is bad.
Exactly. But whew, it was that was an experience. So I just found out that my cat Olivia has been pooping in pyramid form at another side of the basement. So I have to figure out a way to get her to use the box now.
Would it be worth just putting a second litter box down in the basement away from the vent?
That's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to go out tomorrow and get a new litter box for that. Because the thing is, the one we got them is like, see, my cats are spoiled. Okay, they have like the deluxe model with like the roof over it and the little door hatch that swings in and out. So they get supreme privacy.
Mm.
Spoiled little shits they are. But, you know, the fact that Finn has kind of claimed that as his little outhouse, whereas my other cat, Olivia, has to poop in a corner, that's not right. So I'm going to get her a second litter box. And if he starts using both of them just to take over both, he's probably just thinking, oh, another wing for the mana. That's probably what he's thinking. But
just wondering, have you heard the story of the shit lasagna?
The shit lasagna?
Yeah.
It sounds delicious. Do tell.
Do you want me to say it now, or should we save it for a later episode? I mean, it doesn't have anything to do with cats, but it, of course, as the name suggests, it's still a poop story.
Okay, well, you know, we've already told one poop story. We don't want to run out of material here.
Yeah, so I'll make a note. I mean, it's well known. It's not my story. It's something that I've come across on the internet. But shit lasagna, I think I'll save that one. Maybe for the episode 25 special. Disgusting stories.
Exactly. Well, hold on here. You've compelled me to go to Urban Dictionary.
It's a long story. It's very well written and told, but
Assuming. Okay, I'm reading different definitions on Urban Dictionary here, but you know, we'll leave it to your imagination. So here's a challenge for our listeners: think of what shit lasagna might be referring to. And if you're going to eat lasagna for dinner tonight, we do apologize in advance.
I'm eating lasagna right now.
Yum. two lasagnas, one Andy. There we go.
Yep.
Okay, we'll save that for another time. But we did want to touch upon the cat segment because it's always a popular thing. And people found your dick story from last week quite hilarious. So we're going to continue this as long as there's material.
Yeah, I didn't find it hilarious, but I'm glad that other people were able to take joy in my pain.
Other people laugh at your misfortunes. That's just the circle of life right there. Okay. So shall we get into the games we've been playing?
Yeah. What have I been playing? I don't know, man. I need to bring it up because when you get to my age, your brain starts going and you forget. So I'll start off with the Steam Summer Sales.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Steam, they do it around Christmas as well. They just do big discounts on their catalogs, and they've released some good stuff this time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's until the 22nd, so we've still got like 6-7 days left, so it's worth checking out. I went across and I've bought the Humble Bundles, the Indie Humble Bundles, but I've never actually redeemed the code, so I've put those all into Steam. And my Steam collection went from the orange box up to fucking like 30 titles. So I've slowly been going through those, like the Bard's Tale. I bought that as part of the Steam Summer Sales because that's an In Exile game. And they're saying that if you buy that, it helps contribute to the Wasteland 2 project as well. So I bought that. You've got Penumbra, you've got Amnesia, you've got all these other really good titles. So I mean, I've only spent 5 minutes on each of them. I haven't had too much time to game this week, but I mean, if you've got a PC and you like PC gaming, you already know it, but Steam Summer Sales. Check it out.
Mm-hmm.
The other ones I've been playing, I've been delving into a bit of Ristar as well. It's the game that's really kind of, it's the oldest game in my backlog, and it's been burning my ass for many a year. And I'm playing it. I'm over halfway through now, and it's incredibly difficult. The controls are, they're infuriating at times just because of the directions. If you want to try and aim diagonally, Ristar tries to grab vertically. It doesn't quite work too well. And I have been abusing save states on that game. I would not have been able to complete it natively on the Mega Drive without save files. I've just been playing it on the Xbox 360, where you can save it at whatever point, and I've just been abusing the fuck out of that system. So I'm hoping to finish it, but I've run out of gas on it, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed the first couple of levels. They were quirky and neat, but I don't know. It's just become a bit of a chore, a bit of a grind for me, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's the thing with that game, too. I mean, I appreciate it, but I don't enjoy it as much. And the thing is, the controls are really the issue with it, I find. I mean, you get used to it a little bit, and you can make some progress, but I don't know. That game, the controls have not aged well.
To be fair, I don't think they were that great to start off with. I mean, the D-pad isn't really too great for directional controls, and I don't know. I mean, I like it. It's quirky. You could tell a lot of thought went into it. The visuals are great. The music is great. It's got a lot of personality. But I don't know. I don't think the personality quite sits right with me.
Mm-hmm.
I can appreciate it, but I don't thoroughly enjoy it as much as I thought I was going to, which is a shame. But it stood out for fucking years. 15 years, whatever it is. So I need to finish it. I will finish it. I'll put it to bed and I can die a happy man.
There you go. So Andy's bucket list now contains finishing Ristar.
It is. I mean, you do have games that you want to complete that you need to get finished, and for whatever reasons you don't do it. But Ristar is probably the oldest one on my list. So yeah, I will do it. It'll be a slow grind, but I'll get it done. The other one is Final Fantasy Theatre Rhythm. Mm-hmm. Been playing a bit more of that. I'm shit at it. I am thoroughly shit. I've got no rhythm. I struggle, but I'm enjoying it. I mean, I'm not a big fan of the Final Fantasy series. I don't recognize most of the tunes, so it's got no real nostalgia aspect to it. But the music's good. The music's really good. So I can appreciate it just with fresh eyes, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So I'm going through the Final Fantasy III music, and it's sweet. It's good. And the other one, which I have been investing a shitload of time in, and it's one of my favourite games of recent years, and that is Time Crisis Rising Storm. It is fucking awesome. It's out for the PlayStation 3 and in the arcades, and it's the only reason I bought a PlayStation Move. Mm-hmm. I've got the Move and I've got the camera. I don't play anything else on my PlayStation 3 Move enabled at all whatsoever. It's just Time Crisis Rising Storm, and it's just a light gun game, but your light gun, it isn't like a single shot normal handgun. You've got a automatic machine gun, and the environments are destructible, and it's just arcade fun. You just turn it on and you just piss around and try and beat your top score. And it's incredibly camp, incredibly cheesy. It's got a metal soundtrack from Five Finger Death Punch, which is kind of new metal-y slash screamy kind of stuff. It's just my kind of game. It's an ANSI game completely. It's just stupid and it's awesome. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can't argue with it. You go along and you're shooting stuff and you're missing people, but it's crumbling the walls behind them. You're shooting signs out of the way. Then all of a sudden, a big mech comes down and starts shooting rockets at you and you blow it up. And it's fun. I mean, you can get it. It's a budget title now. It's bundled in with Time Crisis 4 and a Pirates game. I can't remember what the Pirates game is called. But it's just worth playing. I enjoy it. And it helps practicing at home, because then you can go to the arcade and impress all the little kids, because you get all the high scores. And you're like, yeah, I'm cool. And they'd say, no, you're not. You're a fucking wanker. Piss off, sad.
Well, no, they'd be standing there going, you have to use your hands with that? That's a baby's toy.
But yeah, I had the same thing for Ghost Squad. I mean, Ghost Squad, our arcades over here are really, really shit. You'll get the occasional light gun games, but most of them are like gambling machines and the claw machines.
Yeah.
I mean, they're really fucking dire. And they're just... our arcades, we don't have standalone arcades. We never really have. They're attached to 10-pin bowling alleys and down at the seafront. And they are. They're just kind of like amusements, gambling slot machines and claw machines. But you do get the occasional light gun games. And we got a Rambo game. In the whole of England, we've had like 5 light gun games ever. We got like a Rambo one. I think we had a Terminator one. We've had Time Crisis 2 and 3. Oh, we've had House of the Dead as well.
Mm-hmm.
A few places have Raising Storm, which is fucking awesome. Ghost Squad. Love that game. It's out on the Wii. I practiced the shit out of that game. And Point Blank, or Gun Bullet, I think it's called. And I really need to learn how to count, because that's more than 5.
I wasn't going to say anything.
Yeah, I'm not into the arcade cabs, but if I ever do get an arcade cab, it will be like Time Crisis, Raising Storm, Ghost Squad, or Gun Bullet, or Point Blank. I mean, I love those games. They're stupid. You just turn them on, you turn off your brain, and it's just reactions.
Well, that's the fun. That's the pleasure of it.
Yeah, so I've been playing a lot of Raising Storm, and they have a leaderboard on there, and I'm nowhere near getting onto the leaderboard, but I want to one day work up, and I'll train. It'll be like a montage. It'll be a Rocky montage, but with Time Crisis Raising Storm. Exactly.
And there we go.
I'll have my very own montage, and it'll be awesome.
It'll be Andy, like, you know, instead of like with the raw eggs like Rambo has, he'll be like pouring a glass of ginger beer and like chugging it. No, that is a good game. Again, it's one of those ones I've been meaning to get to.
As I said, it's the only one that I bought the Move exclusively for it, and I'm not interested in playing anything else on the Move except for House of the Dead Overkill. I've already got that on the Wii, but I might get it on the PS3 as well, because it's fucking awesome.
Mm-hmm. It merits a repurchase.
Mm. I mean, it was a budget title as well, so
It's
awesome.
Cool. Yeah. Anything else you've been playing, my friend?
Nope. That's it, my man. How about you?
Oh, what about me? The big event this week has been Catherine. I finally started playing that. And honestly, do not play that game before you go to bed. That will give you some ridiculously fucked up dreams. And, it's interesting, too. And the reason why I like the game, and I think it's fantastic, I know some people didn't really like the anime style of it. Some people didn't like the whole relationship backstory. It's a love triangle, really, when you look at it. But, I mean, the funny thing is, with the main character, Vince, I identify with him in so many ways, it's unbelievable. I mean, minus the chain smoking and the bad hair and the polka dot underwear. I mean, you know, I'm of the same age as he is, because he's 32, and... you know, kind of going through this crossroads in life where, you know, he has a committed relationship who is looking, the girl's looking to take things to the next level. I'm in that situation as well. You know, kind of feeling pressure from both sides. And it's funny, it manifests itself. I mean, this is where I don't identify, thankfully, but really where the puzzle segments come in, those are like the manifestation of the conflict in his mind. And every stage is like this ridiculous race to the top. Now, anyone who's seen the videos of it, you know, it's kind of like a Qbert inspired game where instead of having to go down and get all the blocks, you have to move blocks to kind of find your way up. And it just gets progressively more challenging because you have enemies who are trying to kill you. You have blocks that are falling as you're trying to get up, and you have to be quick about that. And it's just finding the right way to get up is incredibly difficult at times. Now, I'm playing on easy. And the reason being is that everyone says, even on the normal difficulty, the game is near impossible. And since this is part of my summer backlog challenge, I want to actually give it a good crack. You know, I don't want to be struggling with it and have to rage quit halfway through. So I've been kind of taking it the easy route. And even on easy, it's pretty challenging, I have to say. But I love it. Like, I think it's a very imaginative, very unique game. Like, you've never played anything like this. And even the concept of an anime-inspired life dating simulator story combined with, like, a ridiculously difficult puzzle segment that you play in your underwear, I mean, what is not to like there? But I really like it. And the challenge, I mean, there's so many times where I think your average level, I maybe die like minimum of 10 times. Minimum.
Nice.
And the game looks really good. I mean, the anime cutscenes are fantastic. The load times are very minimal. You do kind of have, similar to games like Mass Effect, you do kind of have what's called a paragon system where, you know, based on the choices that you make, it kind of determines if you're on the good side or the bad side, and how people react to you and how things play out are going to be determined by the choices that you make. So there is that element of, you know, kind of deciding, are you making the right choice? Are you choosing the right person? And kind of the ridiculous side story is you meet this like big-breasted blonde girl who kind of throws herself at you while you have a girlfriend who's like, who's pretty sure she's pregnant and wants to move in with you. So it's like everything is kind of colliding for this guy, and the dreams are just kind of this ridiculous way of working out the conflict in his mind. I think it's a lot deeper than it looks, let's put it that way. And I realize there's a "that's what she said" remark that can go along with that. But no, I really like Catherine. I'm actually surprised and kind of regretting that I held off playing it this long. I think it's a very unique experience that I was just enthralled the whole time. I know the concept might not seem interesting to some people, but it's one of those games you have to actually play to really appreciate. The downside to the game is just the controls, especially when you're on the puzzle segment, because, you know, the left stick kind of moves you and then the right analog stick kind of controls your point of view. The problem is that it kind of goes into an isometric view when you do that, and it's kind of hard to tell which way you have to position yourself so you can move around the blocks, because you can also move behind the scenery too. And it's often been the case where I move behind the scenery and I can't get back out. Like, I don't know which way to move because I can't tell where I am. Some issues with the camera. That's not uncommon of games, but it is a bit of a hindrance here. And just the difficulty can be off-putting to some, but I'm enjoying it. I'm on level 4 now.
Do you know how many levels there are?
I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, I think there's 8.
Okay.
But again, these are long levels, so it's not a game that you're going to get through like in 10 hours. It's going to be, I think, at least a 20-hour game. That's my estimate anyway. It could be longer, could be shorter, who knows. But I don't know, Catherine, I'm really liking it. I chose that as the next game in my summer backlog because, like, I know Rage and Riddick, I'm probably going to get through those pretty quickly. Deadly Premonition is going to be the more difficult one, so I think that's the one I'm going to take on after this. So we'll see.
That'll be a trial for you. Good old Deadly Premonition.
I definitely think so. And anyone on Twitter, anyone who follows me on Twitter, you'll be reading my reactions as I have them, because I've fallen into this habit of kind of tweeting while I play games, which is great. I mean, I love kind of just putting my impressions out there. The problem is that when people reply, I just want to reply back to them. So I'm constantly pausing the game, tweeting, playing the game, pausing, tweeting. I don't know. I'm weird. That's just how I do it.
Yeah, I do it, but it becomes very difficult when you try and play Dark Souls. Because you can't pause in Dark Souls, and I don't know, I'm fucking hooked to social media, man. I can't stop. So I'm always on Twitter, always just checking Twitter, seeing what people are up to. And on Dark Souls, you just can't. And
exactly.
I get killed. So
yeah, Dark Souls is not a good choice. I mean, you have to really focus on that if you want to get through it. Otherwise, it's like every tweet is going to be like half. I just made it to this part in Dark Souls. Fuck. It's like real-time tweeting.
Yep,
there you go. So yep, Catherine, I do highly recommend it. It's definitely not for everybody, but I'm almost regretting not getting that big special edition now.
Yeah, you can't find that over here at all, the pizza box version. Yeah, you just can't find it over here anymore, which is a shame.
I can find it here, but it's always the PS3 version. The 360 version's long since sold out. I might get it just for collector's purposes. Like, it's such a ridiculous special edition, you almost have to have it.
Yeah, my only fear for that, though, if you get a second-hand one, it'll be all crusty and stuff. It'll be nasty.
Yeah, the boxers are going to come used.
Yeah, it won't be nice, so.
It's like you return it the next day, and it's like, excuse me, these boxers have shart stains on them.
Yeah.
There you
Lovely.
Go. Lovely. So, yes, Catherine, good one. I decided to give my PS3 some love because I've actually been neglecting it horribly lately. So I broke out and decided to do a little bit of, a little bit more grinding in 3D.GameHeroes, which I still think is one of the best games on the PS3. Mind you, it's also incredibly difficult and frustrating, but I just love the style. I think if you're an old school Zelda fan, you got to play it. Like, it's a given. But I haven't made it too far in that. I remember buying it and then playing it day one, and maybe playing it at a couple intervals after that, but I've never really made substantial progress. So I think after I'm done the Summer Backlog Challenge, I'm just going to grind through it and beat it. And then, yes, I realize how bad that sounded. I hear you go, like, as if you're about to say something. I'm like, oh, I'm ahead of you on that one. Also, another game is, have you ever played the Force Unleashed games? I know you're not a big Star Wars fan, but have you ever played any of them on the current consoles?
Yeah, they use the Euphoria engine, don't they?
They do.
Yeah, so I love the Euphoria engine. I will play any game that they put out for that. I don't know. I just love it. So I played the first one, completed it, started to play the second one, and kind of got distracted, I think. I can't remember. Because you play as Starkiller, is that right?
Yes, in the second one, I believe.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, it's a game I do want to play because it's the Euphoria engine, man.
I like it. I played the Force Unleashed 2 on the PS3. I have it on the 360 as well, but I decided to play it on the PS3. Honestly, I like it. A lot of people didn't like it because it's a lot shorter than the first one, and it's as linear as they come. Like, you cannot get lost. You cannot. There's very little exploration. It's pretty much just getting from point A to point B on the level, which, given my current state of gamer ADD, I think that's actually a good thing. For me, anyway. But I like it. I mean, I'm a fan of the Star Wars universe, and I do enjoy just those kind of games. I know it's not the best game in the series, and I know people who really enjoyed the first one. Generally, a lot of them I know at least didn't like the second, but I certainly got some enjoyment out of it. I'm not that far into it, but I'm just going to continue playing through it. It's a fun distraction, I guess. It's kind of like, I call it the palate cleanser between some of the other more intense games that I'm playing, because you kind of need those.
Yeah, I think that's what it is perfectly. You just turn it on, chuck some stormtroopers around, and yeah.
Yeah, and that's why I like game. That's why I like racing games, and that's why I kind of like the linear shooters like The Darkness 2 and Red Faction Armageddon, simply because I'm playing games right now that require a lot more brain power, so I need some that are just going to kind of give me that mental relief. Like, it's almost like, you know, if you work in an office and you're at your computer all day, you need to avert your eyes once in a while to something else. So hence why I'll have, like, on my second monitor, I'll have, like, Facebook and Twitter open, so I'll be doing my work, but then I'll have something to kind of distract me on the side. You know, it keeps your brain balanced, I find.
Yeah, which... I tend to just punch my colleagues just as a palate cleanser. I do, like, a support call, and then I punch a dude in the face. Do a support call, and then kick someone in the face.
Yeah, see, that wouldn't quite work for me, because my office is about 90% women.
Ah, so... of course it'll work. They won't fight back. It'll be fine.
I can't do that. Besides, many of them bake cookies and they bring them in the office. I don't want to cut off the cookie supply.
Okay. It works both ways. It will inspire them to bring you more cookies.
I've never seen violence as the excuse for that. I figured try to charm them instead. And should that result in the occasional sexual harassment suit, so be it. But it's either assault or sexual harassment, one of the two. But anyway, as I should say, we're just kidding. We love women.
All of them.
Yep, and we're both contractually bound to one, so, you know, we get it. Or soon to be, anyway. Yeah, so there is that. I also broke out my Wii a little bit, and that also sounds slightly dirty. Nothing I say on this podcast doesn't sound dirty. Fuck. I broke out my Wii, and I decided to play... I started playing Metroid Prime 3, which I actually quite like. I didn't think I would like it, because I really enjoyed the Metroid Prime games on the GameCube. I didn't think they would translate well to the Wii, but I think they did a very respectable job.
Yeah, a lot of people are saying that for Resident Evil 4, I believe, that the Wii version was going to be shit, but it turned out to be the definitive version, so it's good that it carried across.
Well, the controls on... because I have Resident Evil 4 on the Wii and on the PS2, and the controls are definitely more fluid, I find, on the Wii. Which is funny, because you're using your waggle controls, and you do have to kind of shake it. So, for example, there's a point when you're in the lake, and there's this massive monster that takes hold of you. I find it easier, because it prompts you to shake your Wii remote, and then kind of do an upward motion to kind of shake the beast off. It actually works really well. And this is a kind of an example of how the Wii control... Yes, I know. As soon as I said it, dirty fucker.
So you go down to the lake to beat off a big beast.
Oh, I don't even have to go to the lake for that. I'll be happy to stay in the cabin just log jamming.
So. As you were saying, my man, as you were saying.
Oh, we're talking about masturbation here. My mind is totally sidetracked.
You started off with Resi 4 and then it was just wank jokes.
That's kind of how it goes. No, but I did enjoy it. And it's one of the examples of how a Wii control can actually be very well implemented in the right kind of game. And I think that does hold true as well for Metroid Prime 3. I'm not far into it, but I'm almost... because I love the Metroid games. Like, I played all of them. I'm a bit late to the party with the current ones, simply because many other games have kind of come in the way. But I do really enjoy what I played in Metroid Prime 3, but I'm absolutely dreading Metroid Other M. Simply put, because I know they made a lot of changes. I know, what was it, Team Ninja who developed it, and I know they have a pretty good track record, but I heard they just totally dropped the ball on Other M in terms of, you know, making Samus like this damsel in distress, which it doesn't fit.
Yeah, from what I gathered, it wasn't a bad game. It wasn't a good Metroid game.
Yeah, and that it's going to be kind of hard to wrap my mind around it when I finally start playing it. But for anyone who is a Wii owner, I do highly recommend Metroid Prime 3. I think it's a very good continuation of the other games, and the controls are actually really spot on. At least for me, they are. I know some people, they wouldn't like the Wii controls if they were, like, flawless, but that's just a matter of expectations, I guess. But, yep, definitely enjoyed that. And I did decide to, like yourself, I felt the need to get some light gun game action happening there. And what they have on the Wii is the House of the Dead 2 and 3 collection.
Yeah.
And it's funny, because going back to those games after playing House of the Dead Overkill, you realize how dated the other games feel. You really do. And that's not to say they're bad, because I sunk an ungodly amount of money into House of the Dead 2 back in the late 90s when I was in the arcade. Like, we had a movie theater. Because, okay, it was the same back then, though that's more the case now. But really, the only place you can play arcade games is in movie theaters over here. Like, they have an arcade section where they have, like, air hockey tables, a couple arcade cabs. The House of the Dead games have been the staple of those arcade sections. And I played so much House of the Dead 2, it was unbelievable. So, for nostalgic reasons, it still holds a lot of value. Playing it on the Wii, though, it definitely shows the wrinkles. Especially the dialogue and the voice acting in that game is just bloody awful. And as the default, too, like, you actually have to turn the blood on, because the Wii version's default is green. So there is that, but I enjoyed it. I mean, the aiming is definitely not as precise as House of the Dead Overkill. It is a lot more jerky and fidgety, and that's the thing with light gun games. Like, they really have to be fluid, and the controls have to be really easy to use. With this one, and what was it, Resident Evil, I think it was called The Umbrella Chronicles, those are two on-rail shooters. The controls just don't work as well. I think House of the Dead Overkill really nailed it. With House of the Dead 2 and 3, they're still good. They're still very playable, but you definitely need, like, a gun peripheral for those. You cannot just kind of hold it at the screen and click. You need, like, a zapper or the Wii shotgun or something. I use the Sure Shot, which is the handgun attachment.
I haven't actually got any of the attachments. I've always looked at getting one for the Move and for the Wii, because I know I think after this podcast, I'm just going to go and play a bunch of Ghost Squad, because I haven't played that game in fucking ages. And it's like the definitive light gun game for me. I love that game. So I don't know. I think I might cancel the wedding and just buy more light gun accessories.
That is a sensible thing to do. That's a manly thing to do.
Yeah, I think it makes the most sense. I mean, we could spend all this money on a wedding, or I can invest it in light gun accessories and arcade cabinets. Yeah, that's a good idea. You've convinced me, man.
There we go. I am a total homewrecker, but I have no shame.
Yeah, so when Caroline turns into the Incredible Hulk, I'll just say it's your fault.
Yeah, but you're the ones whose balls will be hanging from her earrings, so.
Man, she'll hunt you down.
Yes, I'll go in. I'll be happy to go into hiding after this. So, to those listening, this will be our last episode. It's done. We're done.
Fear for our safety.
Exactly. And if you don't hear from me in a week, send help and a pizza and some beer, too.
Yep. And Kleenex.
Oh, I already have that stocked up. I'm taking a page from Apex Ultima's book. He every episode we have, he always says he went through a whole box of tissues listening to it. So, I've learned to stay well stocked.
Excellent. So you've got like a nuclear bunker, but that fuck any food or water or anything. It's just lube and Kleenex.
Exactly. One wall is dedicated to the 3-ply Kleenex, because I will shoot into nothing less. And the other side is just all like lotions and jellies and what have you, depending on the day, depending on my mood.
Excellent.
Exactly. So those are the games we have been playing, and moving swiftly along, because there's more penis jokes that are going to come from this, I'm sure. what we've been watching. And all right. I did say I was going to go first, but I need to get a drink of water. So, Andy, you lead in.
Okay. So, for me, I'll start with the trashiest part. I've been on like a reality TV kind of kick, and I decided to watch The World's Worst Tenants. And, you know, Dog the Bounty Hunter, right?
Yep, he's got the hottest mane of lion hair.
Yeah. Well, you know how trashy that program is and just how fucking white trash that is.
Totally.
This World's Worst Tenants just makes Dog the Bounty Hunter look like a fucking gent and a half. Makes him look like royalty, like the poshest bastard you'll ever meet. This guy, I mean, they're just housing association dickheads, and they go along. If there's any problems with the tenants, they'll either speak to them or try and evict them. And this guy's a former Marine. He's got a shaved head, except for a triangle of black hair at the back of his head, like at the top of his neck. Mm-hmm. And I think he's trying to grow like a rat tail there, but he's completely shaved bald, except for a triangle of hair and a shitty little rat tail. And man, it's as fake as, I don't know, a fucking $3 bill or whatever they're saying. It's unbelievable. The guys will go there and they'll always get into a fight and the guy will struggle with them. And there'll always be a convenient mattress or crash mat or something for him to chuck the person into. And it's just so fake. And they just try and pass it off as being real. But it's trashy and it's awesome. So he'd go along to a place that had noise complaints and it'd be in a residential area and look really neat and tidy. And he says, oh, yes, it looks all above board, but we're suspicious, so we're going to check it back at night. So they go back at night and, of course, it's turned into like a titty bar or whatever the fuck and they're private prostitution. And they go there and they fight people and it's so bad, so fucking bad. But it's so entertaining. It's so good.
but I think also it's almost like you wish it was real just so you could actually feel something for these people, because I've seen shows like that as well. And I don't know, like you kind of get burnt out on them after a while. Just there's only so much cheese you can stand.
Yeah. They do kind of mix it up a lot though. I mean, I don't know. I've watched two episodes back to back, and that, you're right, there was a limit to it. You can't, it's cheesy overload, but I think I will come back to this one because the variety is unbelievable. They went to a place and they said, oh yeah, we've heard that he's keeping a lizard and they're not allowed any pets whatsoever. So we're going to go and kick down his door and just see what he's got. And of course, it isn't just a lizard that this guy's got. He's keeping chickens just walking around. He's got a million and one birds. He's got fucking, like, I don't know, everything, cats, dogs, everything in his place. And then he goes into the bathroom and of course there's a fucking crocodile in the bath. So they have been very I can't think of the word, creative in their approach. So
yes, yeah, some of these shows, you could just tell they're fake. I mean, there was one show, the name of it escapes me, but it was something similar, where you had these people who were hunting down criminals or lawbreakers or something like that. And what tipped me off that the show was fake is that, you know that iconic scene where they kick in the door and then they stampede in?
Mm.
Well, this was one where they showed it from two angles. One of them was on the other side of the door before they kicked it in. So I was just like, okay, if this is supposed to be a surprising, what, did they just let a camera crew in and wait till they kick open the door just so they can get the person's like physique right as he just fucking plows it through?
It's ridiculous.
It is, but that's kind of like those American sensationalistic TV shows. Like, this has to be an American show.
Oh yeah, yeah, completely.
you can tell.
But I can't remember this guy's name, but if you just Google World's Worst Tenants, you see this guy. He's built like a brick shit house. And you can tell he's roiding up, he's former Marine and all this bollocks, but he's got the shittiest hair you've ever seen in your life. Completely shaved bald, like shiny bald head with a stupid black patch on the back of his head. It's ridiculous.
Now, I should also point out that Andy and I are two people who are prone to rocking the shaved head look. That is not something we would ever consider.
Far from it.
Okay, I'm looking at this guy. What the fuck?
Yeah,
it looks like he's got a. It looks like he's got like a patch of pubic hair back there.
Yeah, it is. It's a triangle. Like he stole it from his wife's pubic region. He waxed it straight off and then just like glued it onto the back of his head.
It's a tribute to his wife's bush, no doubt.
Yeah,
but yeah. It looks like. Oh my god! If you were to take someone with like a hairy vajayjay and just like braid the hair, that's what it would look like. Oh my god! I'm looking at a picture. Okay. If we could do like episode pictures, I would totally make this one our official. People watching can't see it, but I just have to share it. So, yes, that is the world's worst tennis. Now that I see it, I just have to watch it.
It's really trashy, but it's so good. So good. Apart from that, I've been watching the regular show, which is fucking awesome. I can't wait to watch more of regular show. And I implore everyone to watch this. One of the episodes that I was watching, you got two characters, Mordecai, who is a blue jay kind of bird. Mm-hmm. And you've got Rigby, who's a raccoon. So, of course, it's a topic very close to our heart. We've got like a raccoon and yeah, it's awesome. And Rigby was sitting in a cafe drinking Joe with his bro. And they were going to get a new video game. I can't remember what it's called. Something like Strong Men. Mm-hmm. But Mordecai, he's in love with this like pink jay bird creature thingamajiggy who mm-hmm. works at the cafe. And they were going to put their money together to buy this new video game. But instead, Mordecai wanted to get some cologne. It's called Dude Time.
Dude Time.
And apparently, if you spray Dude Time, all the women just flocked towards you. It's like Axe or Lynx or whatever the fuck you want to call it. You spray it and women are infatuated with you. They throw themselves at you. So basically, Mordecai uses his money instead to buy some Dude Time. And it doesn't work. Surprise, surprise. The women aren't infatuated with him. Turns out that a gang of unicorns just appear out of nowhere. Like, dude, it's that Dude Time. Ah. And they take his Dude Time and they start spraying each other with it. And of course, Rigby's well upset because he wanted to drink Joe with his bro. And it just turns out that Rigby falls in with this gang of unicorns and they just go round chanting, bro, 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 bro. And then of course, they turn evil and they need to get rid of them. I can't remember. They challenge them to a drag race is how they finally get rid of them and blow them up. But it's so awesome. It is such a great show. It was Comeback Kid, I believe, who recommended it to me.
Yeah, he was all over that when you tweeted about it.
And he was 101% correct, man. That program is awesome. So I'm going to finish that. And then the other one is going to be the Flapjack, Eric, Nostalgia King. Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack, I think it's called. So that'll be straight after.
There you go. It's funny when you mentioned that one about the Bro Time cologne.
Yeah.
That just reminds me of this show that actually I watched very recently. It was called, I don't know if you get it in the UK, it's called Just for Laughs Gags, which is basically, I'm sure they have shows like it, but it's basically where you play pranks on people in public and you're secretly filming them.
Mm.
But this one was really funny because it was at a mall and they had a kiosk set up for this particular brand of cologne. So they have two desks. Well, they have a desk set up and they have one guy there who's an actor. And then he gets sprayed with this cologne and then he like smells it and everything. And then all these women flock to him and they start smelling him. And then he just walks away arm in arm with like three women. And then you have this other shopper who's not the actor. He's the one who's being pranked. He looks at that. He goes, wow, like that stuff really works. So he goes over there. They do the same thing. They talk to him about the cologne. They spray a little bit on him. He starts smelling it and everything. It smells nice. And then as he walks away, a bunch of dudes come up and start smelling him.
You posted that a couple of months back, I think, on Twitter, and I watched that and I was laughing. It was awesome.
Exactly. It's like, I could just imagine the advertisement. Brought to you by Dick Magnet Cologne.
Just a quick tangent. Have you ever seen Balls of Steel?
Balls of Steel? I have not.
Yeah, it's kind of like a Jackass kind of inspired thing where they would just get a bunch of actors and they would just prank people. So you've got the annoying devil who drives around in a smart car and he will hold up people. He'll strap like a microphone onto the top of it and he'll drive really, really slow down country lanes and create like as much of a traffic jam as he possibly can. And it's just kind of like that immature kind of gag. But one of them, Nedge, I think his name is, and he'll go to shopping malls, and you know the security tags that set off the alarms at the doors? He'll just go around with one of the security tags and set off the alarms. And he'll he'll get the security guards to chase him and see how long he can last. And the way he can win is if he gets into a fast food restaurant before the security guard catches him. But just the public reaction to that is awesome. But one of the episodes, my absolute favorite, he gets clotheslined on an escalator by an off-duty policeman. So he's trying to prank the security guard, and it goes wrong for him because, he gets tackled on the escalator. It's awesome.
That is hilarious.
The one time he has succeeded, he goes into McDonald's, I think, goes straight up to the counter and says, yes, I'd like a Big Mac meal, please, with this, that, and that. And six chicken fucking nuggets. It's awesome, man. It's awesome.
Honestly, I've heard of that show too, and I'm not a big fan of the Jackass series. Like, I think it ran its course, and I've enjoyed the movies, and I've enjoyed some of the TV series, but I don't know. I kind of lost interest in those kind of shows. But I'll definitely check out Balls of Steel because I don't know. Just given the fact that I have a busy life nowadays, I kind of need that escapism.
Yeah, it's immature and it's very, very funny, but Nedge's Urban Sports. If you don't want to check out the program, just YouTube Nedge's Urban Sports. It's awesome.
I'll definitely give it a go.
You sent me a picture on Skype of this guy on World's Worst Tenants with the pubic hair, and the picture you sent me, the guy screaming on the floor, is the guy that had all the pets. So you saw all his, like, aquariums and vivariums or whatever the fuck they're called in the background. So it's awesome.
All I'm just saying is, like, that patch of pubic hair, it's just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I don't understand that. I really, really don't.
I don't know. Each to their own, I guess.
I'm trying to think of what else I've been watching, man. Never-ending Story, actually. I know I wanted to mention the... what I've been reading, but I went back and watched Neverending Story with is it Lamal who did the theme song?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that's just camp as fuck. You can't get any camp. Yeah,
I love that movie though.
The movie, I don't know, the book has just blown it wide open for me. We watched the movie because I loved it as a kid. I've wanted to just have a slice of nostalgia, and I watched it, and there were so many plot holes in that. And there are just so many unanswered questions. So I decided that I'd buy the book. And you can get the book for like $1, $2. It's absolutely nothing. And the book just shits all over the movie completely. It's a lot more kind of darker. The story is more... it's built on the story a lot more. And the best thing is about it, the film is only half of the book. I mean, you read up the first half of the book, you read, and you know where the movie ends. But, you know, Bastion, he gives the, what's her name? The childlike empress, I think her name is. He gives her a brand new name, and her name is Moonchild, which is a stupid name. But in the book, and this is going to be a big spoiler, but not really, he doesn't have the courage to give her a new name. He doesn't even have the courage to say her name out loud. So, of course, the book goes on and builds on the story afterwards. But it's just almost two different stories, completely different stories. So if you like the movie and you are interested in reading, I'll check it out. It's written really well, and it just shits all over the movie. It's unbelievable.
I've only just seen the movie. Like, I've never read the book.
Yeah, I can't recommend it enough. I know Laurie, your friend, she got bored on the book. So, I don't know. I loved it.
It's not for everybody. I think, especially if you grew up with the movie, kind of going back to the book is a little bit difficult. But, again, I don't know. Like, I would like to read it because I know it exists and I enjoyed the story.
Yeah, so. It has a bit more of an adult theme along it. It has a very it has a bit of a social commentary of how the world is today, which is neat, very neat.
Mm-hmm, especially for the time.
Yeah, but yeah, that's basically what I've been watching, my man.
Okay. I pretty much haven't been watching anything too interesting. I've been kind of, you know, on a filler kick, if you will. Just stuff I've already seen, stuff I've already enjoyed, but stuff that is relaxing to me. So I've gone back and I've watched quite a few episodes of The Simpsons. But I still maintain, and I know I'm in the minority when I say this, but I think that series peaked at season 5. Mm. Honestly, I have season 6 on, I haven't really maintained a solid interest in it. But yeah, I've been watching some of the Simpsons DVDs from like episodes seasons 1 to 5, which for me is the golden age. But I don't know, I love watching them. I've seen them so many times over the years, and pretty much whenever anyone breaks out a Simpsons quote from that era, I recognize it right away. It's just I've seen it so many times because I used to watch these shows back when they originally came out. So every Thursday night, it was a big event in our house. We'd watch The Simpsons and we'd record it. So we had all these VHS tapes full of Simpsons episodes, which I still have, actually. And I've gone back and watched them because I never edited out the commercials. So it's interesting to go back and see old TV commercials from the 80s and the 90s. But no, I really enjoy those. And it's just it's stuff that's familiar, stuff that's interesting. You know, you have those shows that you can just go back to and enjoy every so often. Mm. That's one of them. Also, Batman the Animated Series. Because I actually owned, I own the DVD set. It's the entire series of it. But I used to watch it every day after school. Back when I was in junior high, and I love it. I still think the art style holds up amazingly. And again, it's that dark and gritty Batman, which was very much in contrast to, you know, the 1960s Adam West Batman, which is more colorful, kind of slapstick humor. Mm. This one's a lot darker. The Joker's a lot grittier. You know, it's such a good series. And I think anyone who's into the Batman universe and has not seen the animated series from the early 90s, you definitely owe it to yourself to watch it. Because, I mean, the art style is very heavily stylized. You know, it's very much in the style of, like, the graphic novels, if you've read any of those.
That's got Mark Hamill as the Joker.
Yeah, and he and Kevin Conroy, who does the voice of Batman, they reprise their roles in the Arkham Asylum and Arkham City games.
Mm. I mean, Mark Hamill is the definitive Joker for me, hands down.
Which is interesting, because as kind of a side tangent, there was a rumor that just came out about the next game in the Arkham universe. Mm. It might be a prequel. And there's conflicting reports about whether Mark Hamill will return as the Joker. Because he himself has said that he won't, but then again, you know, what the game is supposedly, and again, this is all rumor, but what the next Arkham game is supposedly going to cover is going to be the point where Batman first met the Joker. Hmm. So it's from what they call the Silver Age of the DC comics, so we're talking like the 50s and 60s eras, and also it's going to cover the Justice League too, because when Batman formed the Justice League with, you know, Superman, Wonder Woman, and then others just kind of came into the fold as well, that might be incorporated into the next Arkham game too. So who knows? I mean, this is all rumor, but Mark Hamill, to me, I agree, he is the definitive Joker. Like, it's hard to imagine anyone doing his voice and it not sounding like a pale imitation.
Yeah, I have to admit, I don't like Batman. I think it's incredibly overplayed. Same with the whole DC and Marvel universes. I don't... For comic books, I think they've become too big. But I know I'm going to be the vast minority in saying that. But Mark Hamill, it's just everything right about it. I just love him as a voice actor. He's fucking awesome.
Yeah. So, and that's a great thing about the animated series, too. You can just appreciate the stories. You can appreciate the voice acting and the art style. I mean, I still think it holds up well to this day.
There's a YouTube video of just the best Joker quotes from the animated series. Just the Mark Hamill thing. And you just watch it, and it is an art form. The dude just inserts so much effort and character into his voice acting. It is obscene.
Mm-hmm. I think he does an amazing job of it.
Yeah.
So from Luke Skywalker to the Joker.
Yeah, it's a bit of a contrast there.
yeah. But hey, it's progression. I think they've given me some of the best moments from, like, you know, my childhood watching Star Wars to my maybe more teenage years watching the Batman series. And they actually have the DVD set. The one I have is long out of print, but they re-released the DVDs in, I think, their own individual box sets. But I bought the entire, like, it's a massive box set just with all the episodes. And I love that show. Like, I've gone back to it and watched it a few times since I've gotten it. So there's that. And then I just watched a little bit more of Long Way Round, Long Way Down, that documentary program with Ewan McGregor and Charlie Borman, where they're riding around the world on motorcycles. Again, it's part of those travel logs that I really like. And the one I'm watching now is where they're riding on what they call the Road of Bones, which...
In Russia.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
I watched a documentary last week on that, actually, funnily enough.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll let you talk about that. That's awesome, man.
Yeah, it's awesome. And the thing is, too, it's like these far-reaching areas that I never would have thought about. And I'm looking up what episode it was. But yeah, basically the Road of Bones, it's basically this this highway in Russia. And it's pretty iconic for the region. But that was like one of their most looked forward to aspects of the trip was riding along that. And it's a huge trek that they have. And there's also other episodes where they're like in like deep, like dark Europe, and like they're stuck in the mud and they're unable to get through. Like, these are the parts of Europe where people still, like, a lot of them don't even drive cars. They have like just horse-drawn wagons. And they're helping them get their motorcycles out of the mud. Because some of the weather they encounter, some of just the people they encounter, it's hardship. I mean, you're riding through areas where the climates are unstable, and you know, you're just riding constantly. You're bound to run into some bad weather and some setbacks. And one of the ones is where they're trying to cross a river, and they're just having a horrible time of it. And they have to wait for like a barge made out of like bamboo sticks to get them across. No, it's a fantastic series. I know Eric, Nostalgia King, he's also watched them, and he speaks very highly of them as well. I think anyone who wants a good documentary series, I know Ewan McGregor is kind of like the big name draw of it, but it's not about him. It's about their tour together around the world on motorcycles, and he roughs it as well as anyone else. I mean, I posted a video in the forums of them eating the balls, like the testicles in Mongolia, which people were just like, ugh. Fantastic series. I highly recommend it.
I'm going to watch that now. I mean, just the mere mention of the Road of Bones. I mean, the reason it's called the Road of Bones is because they say 1 million people died making that road.
Yep.
They were just slaves. So they're actually buried in the road. They didn't drag them out. They didn't do anything. They just buried them into the road. And the road... I mean, I was watching the world's most dangerous roads, and they were driving along it in like a Jeep, a 4x4. Mm-hmm. And there were times when they actually had to turn back because they couldn't make it. So I can't even imagine doing it on a motorcycle. So,
well, that's the thing. And that's really where the hardship comes from. And again, he's not exaggerating. Like, 1 million workers died in the construction of it. And these were just peasant workers. I mean, they weren't well paid for it. They were just...
Oh, they were slaves, dude.
Yeah, basically. And a lot of them, their bodies are buried under there, and they've done excavations here and there, but the roads are so poorly maintained as well that even getting through there, and especially when there's floods and there's bad weather, it's really hard to get through. And that makes for some of the most, in my opinion, some of the most compelling moments in the documentary.
Mm.
So you definitely will like it. And even if you're not into like the history of the areas that they're visiting, it's still interesting to see it, because in some areas, like there was one particular one where I think it was in Tibet or... It wasn't Thailand. It was like Tibet or some part in Eastern Asia. They went to get like this authentic massage, which you looked like they were fucking breaking their backs. Like, did this? They went to like a monastery and they just got these ridiculously like intense massages. So no, it's a very wonderfully varied, very creative show that just, it really shows, number one, the friendship between the two of them, and you have to be really good friends to endure that much together.
Yeah.
Because I'm sorry, even the best friends, I mean, fuck, if Andy and I were to do a trip like that, I think one of us would be dead by sundown the first day, probably.
Yeah, we'd end up eating each other, I think, just killing and devouring the other one.
Exactly. I think I'm bigger than you, so I could probably overpower you. But then you're small and you have MMA training, so who knows?
Place Tabasco sauce. Yeah, just as long as whoever wins uses Tabasco sauce or something, it'll be all right.
I'm thinking Worcestershire sauce.
Worcestershire sauce.
Is that what you guys call it?
Worcestershire sauce, yeah.
Because everyone here pronounces it Worcestershire.
Just be lazy and just call it Worcestershire sauce.
Hey, if it works for the SNES, Worcester works for me.
Man, the English language, we created this language and then we just became lazy. We're like, fuck it. We've written this. It's too long. It's too, fuck it. Worcester. Let's just call it Worcester.
I think you Brits have just been resting on your laurels with the language, you know, just truncating and amalgamating words and munting them up and laughing at us foreigners who struggle to pronounce them.
Yeah, and now, I mean, give it a couple of years, we'll just grunt and point. I want that. Give it.
Given the English people I know who are like talking like Henry Hathworth, you know, it's like they're not even words; it's just expressions.
Yeah, so. It's all downhill, man. All downhill.
Exactly. Well, we're not far behind. So the last show I'll talk about here, and then I guess we'll give it a wrap, is Storage Wars. Do you? I know you don't get A&E over in England, but have you seen the show?
I haven't seen it. I mean, I've seen it advertised, and it is on my radar, but I'm not actually too sure what it's about, to be honest.
It's a really interesting show because, I don't know, they have them all over the world, but in America, there's a huge tendency people have to store their valuables in rented lockers. So you have these massive compounds where they have all these storage lockers. So if you're moving or you're currently out of residence or you just don't have the room for all your stuff, you rent out a locker and you keep all your stuff in there. The problem is you have to pay a monthly fee for it, and a lot of people fall behind on that, or they just abandon their lockers altogether. Some people die, some people move away, some people forget about it. But what they do then, when the storage units are abandoned, they put them up for auction. And there's an auction company in the States that actually handles storage unit auctions. So what they do, they have these different units that they open up, and then they have these people. Some of them are professionals, and you get to know them throughout the course of the series, but they go to every single one of these auctions. And what they do, they bid on them. So it's like your standard auction where they pay whatever they think the contents of the locker are worth, and then they try to flip them for profit. So the point of each show, you have like four main kind of players, you know. So you have an older guy who's more into like the odd collectibles. You have the guy who they call the mogul, which his name is Dave Hester. He's such a jerk, but he can outbid anyone. But he is like definitely the most well-established, the most well-funded, and he flips profit on almost everything. And then you have another guy who has like a family business, and then you have like a husband and wife team who run like a consignment store, like a pawn shop, and they constantly need to get new inventory in there. So it's just them kind of infighting and trying to one-up each other. But the rule is, when they open the locker, you can only look inside. They can't go into the lockers. They can't open any of the boxes. So what they see on the surface will determine how much they're going to pay for it. So they look around and they say, oh, that looks like it could be valuable. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes they'll say, this looks like a student's locker. I'm not even going to bother. But it's a gamble, because what happens is, once they bid on it, they bought it, and it's all cash.
Mm.
No refunds, no nothing. And then at the latter part of the episodes, they actually go in there, they look at what they have. Sometimes they come out with some amazing valuables, and other times they just totally go flat. And the show kind of determines if they profited from it or they've taken a loss.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting, actually. And it's funny, one of the things that's become the most popular is the Dave Hester character, because every time he wants to bid on something, all he says is, yep. And he just keeps doing that throughout the show. He actually has hats and t-shirts branded with yep. But it's interesting. I do like that show quite a bit. So Storage Wars is one that I highly recommend. And, you know, it's just interesting to see how kind of people's lives, they kind of put everything they have into that one locker. And, you know, when it's abandoned, what is it worth? One example was one of the guys bought a locker with, it just had a bunch of old newspapers just stacked in bundles. Yeah. And when you think of old newspapers, you don't think they're valuable. You think they're garbage. But what they turned out to be was papers from the day after Elvis Presley died. And they were all like in mint condition. So each one of those papers was worth $1,000 each because of the condition. And how collectible they are, because Elvis Presley still has a massive following, you know, 35 years after his death. So it just goes to show, you never know. So it's a great show. I do highly recommend it. I know some people I talk to on Twitter watch it on a regular basis. I like it quite a bit. So that is everything I've been watching. Anything else you wanted to cover in the segment before we, I guess, wrap it up?
No, man. I haven't got any extras today.
No extras? No more. Just one thing. One thing.
One more thing. One more. No, I'm good, man. I am good.
There we go. So we have had another great podcast. It was just the two of us, but I think it felt good to kind of go a little old school.
Yeah, rough it a little bit.
Exactly. But yeah, we hope to be back next week with a guest, but we do have a question of the week. What do you think about the one I proposed?
If I could remember what you all proposed, I would probably say it'd be fine.
It's in the email.
It's an emo, goddammit.
I put all, okay, to people listening, this is a little behind the scenes information. I put a lot of effort into creating an outline for each episode. Everyone who's been a guest can attest to the fact that it's simple, point by point, and is made for people like Andy and myself who have ADD and just can't focus too much. But it's very simple. He doesn't even keep it open. He's just moving on. He's just like, ah, oh, fuck, Ben made the effort. Not worth it. Nah.
To be fair, there are boobies on the internet. Your outline is on the internet. It shares space with boobies. So I closed it and I went looking for boobies. Can you blame me?
Okay, I can't. But
no, there's no but.
There's no but. Actually, I can't blame you. Boobies take precedent over podcast any day.
Yeah. I've got it open and I love your suggestion. It is the best suggestion in the whole entire world, Ben.
That alone gets me hard. Okay.
Yep.
So the question of the week is, what is your opinion of Kickstarter? And we'll expand a little bit. What is your opinion of Kickstarter and other money-making ventures like it? Have you backed any campaigns? Are there any interesting ones that you think other people should be backing? Or do you have a negative opinion of it? You know, do you think it's e-begging? Do you think it's a bad thing? You know, definitely sound off and let us know what your thoughts on it are. And again, if there's any Kickstarters that you feel are worthwhile, let us know. And assuming they're not over by the time and we're done, we'll promote it probably on the next podcast.
Yeah. Just watch. We'll get a flood of people saying that they've backed Brony projects. Like,
oh, God.
Brony Airways and Brony T-shirts and shit.
Yes, Brony condoms. They're made of rainbows. Brony prophylactics. Brony suppositories. I mean, the possibilities here are limitless.
Yeah. Are you aware of Mr. Hands?
Mr. Hands?
Yeah.
That's what I call my right. Never mind. Yeah, I'm not aware of it, no.
Okay. they're making a... What's Urban Dictionary, Mr. Hands? And then just bear that mental image in for bronies.
Okay, Mr. Hands. I gotta look this up. Can refer to... You're fucking kidding.
Nope, not kidding at all.
You are fucking kidding.
Now, imagine bronies.
I think we need to start a conservation center just to protect the ponies now.
Yep.
I think we have to. And yes, you know, to even look up on Wikipedia, look up Mr. Hands, and one of the first hits on there, it will tell you exactly what it is. I won't tell you what it is. We'll do this. We'll see how many people actually listen to the end here by how many actually go to Wikipedia and look this up.
Yeah, just do not. Apparently there's a video of it, so don't click on any videos.
Yeah, I would avoid videos of that. Usually I'm the kind of person to be like, ooh, it could be shocking, could be good. This kind of thing I don't want to see. But we'll leave that up to you to decide. But anyway, that is pretty much a wrap for today. Anything else we should cover before we sign off?
No, I think your storm incoming is breaking you up a little bit, my man. So I think we'll duck out before you get disconnected.
Okay, is this any better? Can you hear me?
No, you've still got the metallic, man. But it's cool. It's cool.
Okay, so how about we sign off and we'll see you all next week.
Yep, thank you guys for listening, and just don't click on any weird videos on the internet.
without telling us about it afterwards.
Yep. But yeah, thank you for listening, and thank you, Ben, for joining me today. It has been awesome, my man.
As always.
Cheers.
Cheers.